As before, there will be a single debate on all four motions. I will ask the clerk to read the first motion, then call on the minister to move it. The minister will then commence the debate on all of the motions as listed on the order paper. When all who wish to speak have done so, I will then put the question on the first motion. The second motion will then be read into the record and I will call the minister to move it. The question will then be put on that motion. This process will be continued and repeated for each of the remaining statutory rules. So, if that's clear, I shall now proceed. Clerk, would you please read the first motion?
That the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions No. 2, Amendment No. 8, Regulations Northern Ireland 2020 be approved.
Thank you. I call the Junior Minister to move the motion.
I beg to move.
Thanks very much, Minister. The Business Committee has agreed that there should be no time limit on this debate. I therefore call on the Junior Minister now to open debate on the motions, please.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. This afternoon I ask the Assembly to confirm four sets of regulations made in recent weeks. The Amendment No. 8 regulations were made on the 5th of October and came into force at midnight that night. They placed a number of restrictions upon the Londonderry City and Strabane district in an effort to slow a very significant rise in cases in the area, which led to it having one of the highest levels of infection in Europe. Specifically, the regulations placed restrictions on indoor gatherings of more than one household, except in a number of specified instances. The regulations also placed restrictions upon the hospitality industry, so that only deliveries, takeaways, drive-throughs and outdoor service would be permitted. There were restrictions upon hotels and guest houses, so that they could serve food and drink only to residents and at wedding receptions and wakes. The regulations closed specified indoor facilities, including libraries, where there is provision for the library to operate an order and collect service. Finally, there is a general restriction upon outdoor gatherings over 15 people, with exceptions for sports events without spectators and for emergencies. These restrictions were in place from the 5th of October and have been repealed by the next set of regulations before the Chamber this morning. I would note the context in which these restrictions were put in place. Levels of coronavirus in that district at the time were such that it reached an incidence of 635 new cases per 100,000 population by the 5th of October. If allowed to continue, this would inevitably have led to an increase in hospital admissions and deaths, which the Executive knew it had to try to minimise. The Executive's decision to introduce restrictions in the area was also informed by the proximity to Donegal, where additional restrictions had been in place since the 28th of September. And the effectiveness of the restrictions may be seen in the most recent report, where the district has seen a fall to an incidence of 300 per 100,000 population. The Amendment No. 9 regulations were made on the 16th of October. These introduced restrictions across Northern Ireland for a four-week period and are substantially the restrictions under which we are currently living. These regulations replaced both the Londonderry and Strabane restrictions and those put in place by the Amendment No. 4 regulations, which were determined by postcode, initially in Belfast and then parts of Lisburn and Ballymena, and then subsequently across Northern Ireland. Three subsequent amendment regulations have been made to address points of detail in the No. 9 regulations. Amendment No. 10 regulations are now before the Chamber today, and I will address No. 10 together with No. 9. The regulations place restrictions in a number of areas. It restricts overnight stays anywhere other than at home or in the home of a linked household, that is to say, in their bubble. An individual may be able to give a reasonable excuse for an overnight stay in other circumstances. The regulations restrict gatherings in the home or in a private garden. There are to be no indoor gatherings involving members of more than one household and no outdoor gatherings of more than six, not including children under 12, from no more than two households. It is worth noting that the definition of home in this case is not just a private dwelling, but also includes self-contained holiday accommodation, including caravans and self-catering cottages. The regulations place restrictions upon sporting events so that there are to be no sporting events except elite events indoor one-to-one coaching without contact, and outdoor non-contact sport of 15 or fewer participants. The number 10 regulations additionally ensure that dance is included in the definition of sport for the purpose of these regulations. The regulations close a number of specific businesses and services, including close contact services such as hairdressing, driving instructing, campsites and caravan parks for touring caravans, museums and galleries, and a wide range of indoor leisure and entertainment facilities. Hotels and other serviced accommodations were closed, except for specific categories of resident: those already resident, those resident for work purposes, vulnerable people, and anyone not able to return to their own home due to an emergency. The regulations placed restrictions upon the hospitality sector to the effect that businesses cannot serve food or drink to be consumed on the premises, but can sell to order off the premises before 11 p.m. Takeaways can sell for consumption off premises to 11 p.m. Off sales from an off licence, but not from a pub or bar, may carry on until 8 p.m. Face coverings are to be worn in places of worship, except when at a seat, and with an exemption for the couple at a wedding or civil partnership. There are new restrictions on weddings and funerals, limiting numbers to 25, and libraries are able to operate a collection service and to admit people to use internet facilities. We now come to the health protection, coronavirus wearing of face coverings, Amendment No. 2 regulations, Northern Ireland 2020. These regulations add to the two previous executive decisions on face coverings to be worn on public transport and in retail settings. The regulations also require face coverings to be worn by customers of hospitality settings, except where they are seated. They must be worn in an airport and when travelling by plane. They must be worn by staff in retail or hospitality settings, unless they are separated from the public by a screen or partition, or unless they are in an area not open to the public and they are able to maintain social distance. In addition, face coverings must be worn by customers of banks and other similar financial institutions, and those travelling by private bus, coach or taxi. Drivers of buses, coaches and taxis must also wear a face covering unless they are separated from the passengers by a screen or partition. A face covering must be worn in those parts of a building used by a Northern Ireland department which members of the public enter to access services. Finally, driving instructors, examiners and their students must wear a face covering. It is important to point out that staff can ask customers to temporarily remove their face coverings if it is necessary to prove their identity. The reasonable excuses not to wear a face covering are unchanged. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I know that many members will have a number of questions and comments that they want to put onto the record during this debate, and I look forward to it, and I look forward to winding up. However, for now, I beg to move.
Éirim Sir Colin McGrath, Caithrelach and Coiste Chomhaimnish. I call Colin McGrath, the Executive Office Chair.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I rise to speak on behalf of the Committee for the Executive Office. The statutory responsibility for scrutinising these regulations lies with the Health Committee, of which I'm also a member, but I look forward to hearing about the Committee's deliberation later in the debate from its Chair. The Committee for the Executive Office has delivered a consistent message throughout this pandemic, and that message has centred very firmly around urgent compliance with the restrictions that are in place. Our ability to reduce the levels of COVID-19 is largely dependent on the public's support and understanding of the restrictions, and the Executive's communication strategy is key to achieving that. Information campaigns need to be relevant, informative and impactful, and I welcome the updated campaign, which includes personal testimonial to communicate the absolutely devastating human cost of COVID-19 and the undeniable value of complying with the restrictions that are designed to protect people and save lives. I would now like to say a few words in my capacity as an SDLP MLA. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I want to begin by once again highlighting how many of the announcements that will have been made by the Executive have been trailed on TV, and we saw that yesterday. This is unacceptable and it has to stop. Today, we have many in the close contact and hospitality sector who are very unhappy about elements of the announcement made on TV yesterday, and this has caused uncertainty and stress, and the decisions haven't even been taken yet. This is irresponsible government, and it needs to be knocked on the head. It is grandstanding and trying to curry favour with the public by being seen to be inside the loop or being seen to provide little nuggets of information, and it's unhelpful. The executive should be allowed to make its decision, and then that decision should be relayed to this House, and then a proper informed campaign to update those affected should follow. The Executive Office should endeavour to at least get right that which is within its power, and that includes not leaking like a sieve, briefing the media ahead of meetings, and slipping information to the public without the full details in place. Such remarks as restaurants being able to open without selling alcohol show how the lead parties of the executive are so detached from reality. Such a policy will not work. If the medical science says close, then the sectors must close. But it is up to the executive to make sure that those family businesses and those employers, those in the hospitality sector, are compensated for such an enforced closure. To leave the hospitality sector high and dry is totally unacceptable. But is this what will happen? Well, we don't know, because the information has been leaked and drip-fed, and there hasn't been the substance behind it. Mr Deputy Speaker, through the first wave of the pandemic, everyone, in a sense, knew where we stood. We were quite literally all in it together. As the numbers gradually came down over the summer months, there was much said by members of this House cautioning the executive not to just take the foot off the brake completely, but to be conscious of a step-by-step approach. Yet as the restrictions have eased, as a greater sense of pre-COVID normality has returned to our lives, what we have seen week on week, day on day, has been an increase in the numbers of those testing positive, an increase in the numbers of those admitted to hospital, and sadly, an increase to the numbers of those losing their lives to this awful disease. Mr Deputy Speaker, something clearly isn't working. There is now a palpable tension amongst many of the sectors in the North, which has been amplified as a result of these restrictions and televised announcements. We hear from those within the hospitality industry saying that they cannot decide if some in the executive simply do not understand their plight or if they just don't care. We hear those within the hairdressing and beauty sector telling us, why should this one-size-fits-all approach apply to us as well? The level of contact in a hairdresser's is substantially different than that in a bar. Why can we only have 25 people at a funeral or a wedding, but at the same church service, you can have upwards of 150 people present at other services in the same day? Mr Deputy Speaker, many within the sectors in the North are telling us that they feel isolated and alone. What I am hearing very clearly from them is a sense of, yes, lockdown if we need to, but give us the real and lasting support that we need to get through this so that we don't have the colossal figures of job losses. We have to acknowledge this while being fully aware that this is what is happening in the South and what is happening in GB as well. Perhaps what worked so well in the first wave of the pandemic that helped bring these numbers down was the cohesive approach made by North and South and those within GB. On the 21st of October, we saw the South move up to its highest level of restriction, level 5. This was replicated in GB when the announcement was made on Halloween that they too were heading for a further lockdown. This disease does not recognise borders. It does not recognise gender, age, sexuality, constitutional identity, job or class. To those who feel isolated and alone at the minute, they have to know that we are all of us in this together. Mr Deputy Speaker, on the 23rd of March, the Deputy First Minister spoke to this House and used the strongest language possible when she said of the actions of some over the preceding weekend, doing any of those things puts more and more people's lives at risk. We collectively at the Executive and Assembly need to send out the strongest possible message You are killing people by doing those things. It is time not for soft language, but for us to be very straight with people. To those in our community who continue to flaunt the restrictions and treat this as one big conspiracy theory, let me reiterate the Deputy First Minister's words. You are killing people by doing those things. There remains, Mr. Deputy Speaker, some concerns about the process of how these health amendments are made. I welcome that the Health Committee agreed to my proposal last week to write to the Executive and ask if there is another way that regulations can be presented to this House. What we are being asked to approve today includes, for example, Amendment No. 10, which is a series of components that rescind or change the decisions in Amendment No. 9, which we are also going to take today. Now, many of these are needed and required, but it can seem quite silly that we will approve Amendment No. 9 and then immediately change them seconds later by approving Amendment No. 10. It is silly. There was a justifiable reason to using this method at the beginning of the pandemic, but now that the changes are more focused and at times are amendments to previous decisions, to make such amendments and then wait 28 days before discussion here is a futile process. There needs to be greater accountability and transparency, and given that we hear much from our TVs, radios and papers rather than in the chamber, a fresh approach might be most welcome and appropriate. Mr. Deputy Speaker, many will be unhappy with the decisions taken to manage this pandemic. Many will have been directly impacted financially and in terms of business productivity by the decisions, and that is difficult for them. They will wonder why they have had to be the fall guy for managing this pandemic. The bottom line is that there is direct evidence that certain sectors and certain behaviours are directly leading to a rise in the numbers of cases, and we all accept that a rise in the number of cases leads to more hospital admissions, more ICU beds being needed, and more people invariably dying. Therefore, it has been necessary to reduce person-to-person contact, and of course, is more prevalent in certain places and trades than others. Even the mere way people go about retail shopping versus spending an evening in a bar are different, and one can result in more close contacts than others. I would urge the Executive to continue to follow the medical advice that is provided. We need to endorse and follow the advice of Michael McBride and Tom Black and others in the sector. They are at the coalface. They see the harsh reality and have to sit down and explain to families why their loved ones have died, and the virus potentially, with it coming in with people, have to choose who it is and who it isn't that will get a hospital bed. Coronavirus is complicated. Its impact and spread is complex. I'm sure you can contribute after and will. It's complex, so there cannot be a one-size-fits-all approach to all sectors. But if this executive is asking businesses not to open and not to operate and not to make money, then there must be an appropriate compensation that is made available for them. We cannot enforce closure and not provide support. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I conclude by, as ever, supporting these amendments, but have to say that my patience is wearing thin in terms of supporting the method for making these decisions. But the Executive needs to get its finger out and start developing a more coherent strategy for managing the people that are impacted by the decisions and the longer-term exit strategy that we will need from this pandemic. It needs to deliver for the sectors that it enforces to close. We are now 3 weeks into a 4-week lockdown, and Mr. Deputy Speaker, nobody has received any payments for the schemes that are there to help and assist them. And that is leaving people in a very scary, very frightening position in the mouth of Christmas, and leaving businesses that have to make a number of costs and a number of outlays, and they are unable to do that because the payment scheme hasn't begun. The staff are getting paid, but the employers aren't, and they are being left to struggle, and that is unforgivable. Thank you.
Éirim Sir Colm Gildon, Yuhan Cainte, Sin Caithirleach, and Coiste Sláinte, the Chair of the Health Committee.
Gormagad, Lascian Corlia. I want to begin today by first of all acknowledging that we have crossed the very sad milestone in terms of the Statistics Agency records in relation to COVID-19 has now gone beyond 1,000 deaths in total across that, and I think that's a very sobering milestone to have reached and sets the context for our discussion today. I would like to begin by raising a number of points around the process by which these regulations are made and the impact that has on scrutiny before turning to the detail of the regulation themselves. As usual, due to the pandemic, these rules have been made and come into effect subject to post hoc scrutiny. As I have outlined before, the absence of engagement on policy development, stakeholder responses to consultation or impact assessment means the committee's scrutiny after they are made is both more difficult and more important. As I have previously advised the House, the committee has raised with the Minister of Health and health officials on a series now of occasions the challenge of conducting post hoc scrutiny in the absence of supporting documentation, which informs the Minister's recommendations and the Executive's decisions on whether or not to agree the regulations. Under the current process, the committee considers it reasonable to expect clear information on the advice supporting consideration of regulations, including modelling of their anticipated impact, and has requested that such papers be supplied for such regulations as a matter of course. The 28-day period for scrutiny is designed to compensate somewhat for the urgent process, creating a little breathing space for the committee to observe the regulations in action and to question officials on the early weeks of their operation before coming to a view. That space has allowed stakeholders to contact members with queries and comments that have informed scrutiny and on several occasions has resulted in subsequent regulations being made to address flaws and issues identified. Members discussed the challenge, however, particularly in terms of public understanding of debating regulations a number of weeks after they have come into effect, and sometimes after the point where they have been already superseded. The provision of appropriate supporting documentation is one important step that would assist the committee in conducting its scrutiny more quickly. The committee agreed to write to the First Minister and Deputy First Minister to request a review of the process of dealing with pandemic-related regulations. The committee is keen to work in a constructive and timely fashion, but also to perform its scrutiny in a meaningful way. The use of a ministerial statement to announce the restrictions did create some opportunity for preliminary discussion and enable questions to be asked from a range of perspectives beyond health. Turning now to the detail of the regulations, the committee asked a number of questions on Thursday that could not be answered by officials, but which have since been addressed in correspondence received on Friday evening. Noting that Amendment 8 has largely been revoked, the committee sought to explore the impact to date of Amendments 9 and 10. Officials were not able to provide detail, and the subsequent letter referred the committee back to the update of the 27th of October, by which point R, in terms of new cases, was estimated to have fallen below 1, though it was acknowledged that this was likely to have resulted not just from the first 10 days of the north-wide restrictions, but also from the earlier restrictions in the Derry and Strabane council area. The junior minister may be able to provide a more up-to-date picture for us in relation to that today, and we would welcome that. Members also considered the further requirements to wear a face covering, making a number of inquiries in relation to that. We inquired whether it might be beneficial to adopt a more straightforward approach, requiring face coverings in indoor settings more generally, whether any analysis had been undertaken into the impact of improper use of face coverings, and whether there had been consideration of providing face coverings free of charge. Written advice received after the meeting asserted that when there is very prolonged close contact between individuals, cloth face coverings will not offer effective protections, and therefore extending the regulation to require blanket wearing of coverings would not be justified. There would appear to be quite a range of circumstances between requiring masks in indoor settings generally and very prolonged close contact situations. So I'm not sure this fully addresses the point raised, but I shall leave it to other committee members to elaborate on that. The Face Coverings Working Group has considered, but not recommended, free provision of face coverings, we are advised. The Minister's letter also restates that evidence overall suggests the use of face coverings reduces transmission of the virus, but cautions that improper use does diminish or eliminate their benefits, alluding also to limited evidence of harm through individuals paying less attention to other mitigations. Members challenged the inconsistency in junior pupils having to wear face coverings on school transport, but not in retail settings. The Minister has advised us that this will be reviewed by the face covering working group, but noted that prolonged close contact is more likely on a school bus than it would be in a retail situation. A further issue that came to the attention of the committee was the current loss of close contact services, such as massage, for those suffering from a range of conditions. Officials advised that where such services are ancillary to health and social care treatment, they remain permitted. However, written advice supplied after the meeting has confirmed that this is confined to services commissioned by the HSC. The committee further inquired about enforcement and awaits a reply on this matter. Sinead Anish, last can I call you, Gorma Agat.
Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And my thoughts are also with those families that have been bereaved throughout this pandemic, whether that be COVID or non-COVID conditions. Certainly a very trying time for families and dealing with grief in a very, very different way. Mr. Deputy Speaker, we meet in this Assembly again to approve regulations after they've already been put into effect. And by now we are more than familiar with the process, but that in no way takes the pain of impact from these regulations before us. We are in a difficult situation as a society, an unprecedented situation, a dangerous situation where the threat to life is real. And let me be clear, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that the threat to life I speak of today comes from COVID-19, but it is not the only threat, for the threat to life also comes from undiagnosed cancers, untreated cancers, heart disease, to name but a few conditions. It also comes from a mental health crisis that we should be in no doubt will only get worse and will cost lives. The disease of despair that comes with losing a job, with not having money to support those you love. I do worry for Northern Ireland. I worry for its people, its economy, for the fabric of our society. And in this context that we look at, the restrictions that the executive has brought in, and which will fall on Thursday night. And let's make that clear, they do fall, these particular restrictions, on Thursday night. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I will largely be focusing my remarks on Amendment number 9. These restrictions are not aimed at making the situation worse. They are motivated and designed to steady the ship, to maybe make things a bit better. Certainly, it is about giving our healthcare system the space to help those in need and to actually survive the pressures that the health service is facing today. I recognise the sacrifice that we are making, or we are asking people to make. And with reference to paragraphs 7 and 8 of Schedule 2, I have friends and family who work in our hospitality industry and in close contact businesses such as hairdressers. And my heart goes out to everyone whose job, whose dream has been thrown in doubt because of COVID-19. And I want to commend my colleague, the Economy Minister, for the response she has led to these restrictions and in supporting jobs and livelihoods. It gave hope where people thought there was none. But there are issues within these regulations that money doesn't fix, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I look to paragraph 10 and think about couples who want to get married and who want to have what all young couples want, to be surrounded by friends and family and to celebrate that time together. And it is cases like this, examples such as these, that we do need to ensure clarity in terms of timescales. You cannot plan a wedding in a day any more than you can plan to reopen a restaurant in a day. So in terms of how we decide and how we inform those impacted, I urge timely notice. And I know the First Minister shares that view with me. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I want to touch on our health service. It is creaking under pressure it faces right now, but buoyed up by the incredible staff we have and their commitment, and I know we can see it through. Playing their part are student nurses, and I call on the Minister of Health today in particular to ensure that these student nurses are paid for putting their shoulder to the wheel, just as they did in the first wave. And I would also urge the Minister to look at what can be done for those in those hospital settings. Those getting bad news possibly not COVID-related, being left to receive that news on their own. And we've heard of many instances throughout our constituencies of those who are suffering through loss and through pain. And I'm also thinking too of those who have a deep desire for spiritual guidance in those situations as well, but whose Minister of Religion is not allowed into that hospital setting. And I urge the Minister to look at these issues and see how they can be addressed. We need to find our compassion again. In conclusion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, there is a need to give people hope. And this is where I welcome the words of the First Minister in terms of learning to live with COVID-19. And we need to devise, and I would say we need to do it very quickly, a strategy that lets our economy continue and where we can break the cycle of lockdowns. We do need to find a way whereby schools and hospitality can be open, not a pick or choose approach. We also need more help in Northern Ireland. Let's take whatever assistance is available to us from the Army. Surely there are many roles that they could be assisting as they do across the rest of the UK. And testing is just one example. Track and trace, helping with infection control, dealing with the logistics around our health service of the vaccination programme to come. And I do welcome the news that's coming today on the very positive results from the vaccination programme. I will finish by yet again appealing to all to abide by the restrictions, no matter how unfair they may feel. We do need to play our part, and I firmly believe that by following the most basic of advice in a long-term way, and that's the hand washing, the covering our mouth and nose where appropriate, and keeping our distance from each other, we can avoid these draconian restrictions if we follow these measures. These measures will keep our hospitals from being overwhelmed. Don't listen to me. Listen to any one person working on COVID wards or in an ICU unit. And ask them if coronavirus is real or is it a hoax. I look forward to hearing the executive's latest decisions, hopefully later today, and to debating them in due course in this House. Thank you.
I can now call Mr. Steve Aiken, but Mr. Aiken, if you bear with me, I may have to interrupt to adjourn for question time, depending on how much time you take. So,
Sir, okay. Deputy Speaker, I intend to finish by 1400, so you shouldn't have that problem whatsoever. And I normally have been accused of a degree of verbosity, but not on this occasion. Because I think right now we have a serious situation in here that with over 1,000 deaths noted in Northern Ireland from COVID, this is not a statistic, this is a tragedy. This is a tragedy for all those people affected in Northern Ireland for this particular issue. But I also like to say today that for many times we've been concerned about there's been a lack of hope. But I do hope, as indeed the Vice-Chair of the Committee said today, that the results that's come from the Pfizer trial and it's come also from the BioNTech trial on the vaccine, which shows a degree potentially of up to 90% effectiveness, I do hope that we have now reached a turning point. And equally, I do hope when we look at AstraZeneca and the other areas that are working as well, that we're now beginning to see maybe a light at the end of the tunnel where we can get to. And I think all members of the Assembly here would wish to welcome the opportunities of the biotech industry, and particularly our own pharma sector, and indeed our own universities who have been involved in many of these trials, and we would wish to support them to get to the fullness of this support as quickly as we can. But for these regulations, I think the key to this as well, this is an executive decision, and I'm glad that the junior minister is here in front of us, because it is up to all of the executive together to come to collectively to make the best case that we have to be able to defeat this virus. And despite the fact there may be a vaccine on the way, we indeed need to be able in a position to defeat this virus and make this clear. And indeed, nobody wants to see regulations coming in front of this Assembly that have already been passed. Everybody wants to have the opportunity to have at least 28 days to consider these regulations. And indeed, as Chair of the Finance Committee, we would be delighted if we would actually like to get some information that comes through to us normally ahead of time. And indeed, most chairs of committees sitting around here, we'd be delighted if we managed to get information that we didn't have to push through on accelerated passage, and we did have that timely flow of information we came through. But for once, particularly in this area, I think the Department of Health and indeed the Executive has an excuse, because we're in a rapidly changing environment. We didn't expect to get to the position where we're going to have a second wave. But even though we knew if we didn't follow all the precautions, it could come back, and regrettably, it has. So here we are in a situation where we're being asked on behalf of the executive, because this is an executive decision from all the executive ministers around that table, for these rules and regulations to be brought in, even though most of them are going to be superseded fairly shortly. I would also like the junior minister to be able to update us, because indeed, and I agree particularly with the chair of the executive committee, it's the flow of messaging and information. We seem to be finding out more about it in the media. Now, we haven't quite got to the point where we're hearing about everything on Twitter, but at the moment, I think, as a member of the Assembly, I would like to be getting that information here first. I would also like the leaking to stop, because it does seem to me a bit strange that I find out more about what's going on within the executive and what's likely things are about to come from the BBC than I actually find out from our own ministers, and indeed through the own process as well. So I'd like the junior minister to address that. And indeed, as far as to make sure that people are aware of it, I have raised this matter at the party leaders' forum as well, because we must be able to have effective government, because this indeed is a decision of all the executive. But there are some issues I think we do need to address, particularly for our excluded and for our businesses. They must feel as if they are being supported. They must feel as if people are listening to them. And yet, last week, we had Barnett consequentials of another 400 million. If we add that to the potential projections that the Finance Minister has already looked at, that is half a billion of support from our country, from our Treasury, that we have to spend by the end of the financial year. What is our Economy Minister doing about that? We have already seen communities and finance have already made efforts to do that, but here we are. Some of our companies and some of our excluded, after close on 8 months, have still not had any financial support. Yet there is financial support there. What are we doing about it? And indeed, that is something that we need to address. Because one of the things we must do for all of the people in Northern Ireland, if we are to have an effective health message and an effective message for dealing with COVID, we need to realise that we all need to be in this together. That means we shouldn't be going around to funerals when we shouldn't be. That means our MPs shouldn't be sort of mouthing out behind the scenes and putting out false truths. That means we must get behind the advice of our chief scientific officer and our chief medical officer. That means we must get behind the advice of our health minister, but also from our executive as a whole. But things are not helped by poor messaging and by leaking. Let us work closely together to sort this issue out and to make it happen. Finally, but not least, I want to talk about our NHS. For those of you who are in any doubt, and indeed within South Antrim, we have one of the best hospitals in Northern Ireland, and indeed some of my constituents have been working sterling efforts to ensure that they are be able to fight our way through this COVID pandemic. If anybody doubts that COVID is real, if anybody doubts the impact that it's having, just try and get into A&E. Just try and talk to the people where 30, 40, maybe more people are waiting to be admitted into wards. This is not a normal circumstance. This is not a normal situation. And when we look and talk about these regulations and how we're trying to get these regulations, and we listen to the concerns about them not being led in time and them coming late and 28 days before we got to and the rest of it, let's take ourselves out of here and just position ourselves and look at what's happening with our healthcare professionals and listen to them. For whatever we do, we must do it to help defeat COVID. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I think that takes me up to minute 58 and 01 seconds. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Members, we are now returning to the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Number 2, Amendment Regulations. And I now call Paula Bradshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and thank you, Junior Minister, for being here today.
Yet again, we face the oddity of debating regulations which are, in effect, well out of date. I welcome at least that we are covering a range of amendments today. The evidence presented by the First Minister and Deputy First Minister in mid-September was that transmission was largely in households. It appears, not least from the evidence bank now published by the Department itself, that this evidence was already outdated. The SAGE evidence of 21st of September already clearly stated that hospitality and universities were significant drivers. Last week, the Chief Medical Officer confirmed that that you cannot have schools and hospitality open and keep transmission declining. For example, in August, there were far more applications per head of population for the Eat Out to Help Out campaign in Northern Ireland than any other region of the UK. And it was exactly at this time that transmission levels rose to the highest than in the rest of the UK. This may be a false correlation, of course, but unfortunately the subsequent evidence, such as that from the University of Colorado and the University of Warwick, especially around aerosol transmission, backs up that hospitality was a clear risk area. One consequence of the test, trace, isolate system not working to maximise efficiency is that we did not have clear evidence and do not have it at present about the sources and chains of infection here. To be clear, there was good evidence for the restrictions on household gatherings, although they appeared to have been made limited, if any, in difference to transmission levels in the postcode areas in which they were initially introduced. What has clearly made a difference are these restrictions introduced in Derry and Strabane on the 6th of October and elsewhere 10 days later. We can see that even in the Castle Derrick area, where transmission rates were not as high as elsewhere in the council area, those rates dropped notably to among the lowest levels in Northern Ireland by the beginning of last week. This presents us with some useful information and knowledge, but also with a conundrum. The good news is that to some extent now we know what works. The bad news is, well, we also know what works, in the sense that we absolutely do not want to close down an entire economic sector potentially for a year or more. We should be concerned about that close down, and we should not be afraid to challenge it. For example, when it came down to closing close contact services, there was genuine confusion. It was only much later, for example, that clarification came that holistic therapies could only be offered upon a referral from the Health and Social Care Board sector. Why was this not clarified at the outset? And it was only after the Health Committee requested that information last week that we received it today. And I know that there's many businesses, small private enterprises, who would have appreciated that information a long time ago. Turning on now to face coverings, the challenge was demonstrated in committee last week when we found that insignificant consideration of the latest evidence had gone into the development of the actual regulations around face coverings. If these are to be enforced, there needs to be more straightforward application of the regulations. The evidence is clear that they dramatically reduce transmission in all indoor public spaces. That is the starting point for living with the virus. And this is a phrase that we know that the First and Deputy First Minister have used in recent days. There seems to be a profound misunderstanding about what we are trying to do when we introduce such regulations. An issue is not just that the epidemiological evidence, but also the presentation of regulations, which are clear to the public and easily enforced. I continue to inquire why some locations are included and why others are not, why some ages in some places are applicable but not in others, and I'm referring to our pupils and transport. It is confusing and ultimately suggests that the executive is not entirely serious about the need for face coverings at all. The simple fact is that they should be worn by everyone of post-primary age and above all in indoor public spaces. There is no doubt that a simple law to that effect would achieve much higher compliance and acceptance. Turning now to the test, trace and isolate. Before we consider taking significant steps out of the current closed-down restrictions, we need at least some of that evidence to be presented. We cannot pull out of the side street unless we have a clear view of the traffic on the road ahead. The test, trace, isolate system was not giving us that clear view. I warned last time we discussed the regulation amendments that we should not waste these 4 weeks. By mid-November, contact tracing had to be reformed and resourced so that it could provide us with clearer and more specific information about the origins of the infection and thus how we could best intervene without closing down entire sectors to break the chains of infection. So the question now arises, what steps have been taken to reform and fix the test, trace and isolate service? Are we going to test, as in the Republic, anyone who has been in contact with a positive test in order to identify better who must be isolated? Are we going to trace faster? And are we going to do more to encourage and ensure self-isolation? This matters, Mr. Deputy Speaker, because without doing these things, there is no way we are going to be able to see the route is clear to reopen, at least some aspects of hospitality, without knowing, and I do mean knowing, that rising transmission and thus closing down vital health services once again is an inevitable consequence. So the challenge is to hear what changes are to be made to the test, trace and isolate system and to update on the face cover regulations that would enable us to make significant amendments to the restrictions as they have applied to Derry, Strabane since the 6th of October and the whole of Northern Ireland since the 16th of this month. I hope the Minister, the Junior Minister, will address these in his response. Thank you.
I call Jonathan Buckley.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to my feet to speak today as now a newly formed member of the Health Committee, and I make no bones about it, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I am on record stating my viewpoint in relation to the specific set of regulations as sceptical and critical at the time, and I can say that I am still as sceptical and critical today as the day that they were introduced. My party is on record on the matter, and I think that members can reflect there's a wide consensus across our differing opinion across the chamber as to the approach that should be adopted going forward. I took great interest, Mr. Deputy Speaker, in not only listening to other ministerial colleagues from different parties, but indeed the junior ministers, who are on record as saying that we need to live and coexist with this virus. And indeed, I think it was the junior minister himself that said we can't legislate our way through COVID. I very much support that line of thought, and I think that as we have learnt to come to terms with the devastating effects that COVID has had on our society, we have also learnt that lockdown is simply not the answer, and it is simply not a sustainable mechanism and strategy going forward, because it is built purely on the premise that by lockdown you mean you need a solution via a vaccine. If that vaccine, and we've heard promising conversations through the media today that we are on the positive note in relation to vaccines, but the premise of a lockdown is based solely on the need for a vaccine. But we have to look at long-term sustainable solutions and learn to live and adapt with the society that we are now in relation to COVID. Absolutely.
For giving way, and just as he touches upon the issue of a potential vaccine, which is very exciting and very good news, would the member agree with me that the failure to secure his urgent oral question on the COVID outbreak coming from Denmark, the new variant strain. Does the member agree with me this is a very serious situation, that whilst UK have locked down borders temporarily with Denmark for now, that the Republic of Ireland really
order,
need to do the
order.
Same?
Would the member take her seat? It is not an order to challenge a decision of the Speaker. I'd ask the member to continue if she wished, but not to challenge the decision of the Speaker.
Thank the Deputy Speaker for that ruling. Would the member agree with me that it is vital that the Republic of Ireland do act in a way that will also protect Northern Ireland when we're dealing with variants of this COVID-19 virus?
Thank the member for her intervention, and indeed I would agree in the spirit of her language in relation to it is quite a worrying development seeing COVID-19 mutate across into an animal species such as mink. We do know that Northern Ireland doesn't have any mink farms in particular, but it is quite alarming to see that there are those mink farms on our periphery in relation to Donegal and etc. And it would have been preferable probably to have a minister to talk on that issue here today, but unfortunately we are where we are, as has been outlined by the Speaker. The regulations need to be targeted, balanced and proportionate. And I suppose, This is what society has been grappling with since the moment we ever had regulations introduced. And this is why many in this Assembly called for targeted data and evidence to show why their target or why their sector was targeted with such an approach that we have. The different sectors affected, and we heard from the hospitality crying out for much needed intervention to look at different ways in which that they themselves as an industry could coexist with the virus. And I think maybe the junior minister hopefully will elaborate some more on this, because I understand there has been a lot of work carried out by both him and his colleagues in relation to looking at the hospitality industry and how they can potentially become COVID compliant. Because I think members will join with me in asserting this point, that while there may have been some businesses that did sadly act irresponsibly, but there were many businesses across the breadth of this country that kept in line in spirit of the regulations that were introduced. And when they were given the opportunity to reopen, thankfully, they acted in an appropriate way and very much in compliance with those basic health messaging, good hygiene practices, space, distance and face covering. So I would expect that the junior minister will elaborate further on that in his interventions. But the sectors were not the only people that were calling into question a lot of these regulations that were put in place. And I mentioned this in a budget speech, in the third budget speech. And it was within a document, Finding a Balance to Protect Our Community and Our Economy. And it was released by a number of businesses. And some of its content, I think, needs repeated here today. The executive's decision to place large parts of the economy into another lockdown will quite simply result in another round of job losses, which will ultimately impact upon livelihoods. Those who have had to shut their doors are deeply concerned by the decision after following the executive's own guidance and investing money they didn't have in making their businesses life viable. They are understandably anxious about the viability of their businesses and their jobs and have created, and so too are many companies who are in the supply chain who rely on them for their footfall. Our economy is an ecosystem, and closing down one part of it isn't into a limited intervention harms us all. Pursuing a path down, and I think this is the crucial element, pursuing a path of lockdown, release and repeat will undo all of the good work we have done to build a strong and diverse economy. To build a strong and diverse economy and protect workers and their families. At that stage, I will give way.
I thank the member for giving way. One of the things that he read into the notes was that the economy went into lockdown. It wasn't just the economy that went into lockdown. Homes and families and everybody suffered here. Just want to ask the member if he would tell me what he thinks about the success of the 6-week restrictions, in the word draconian restrictions, in the London Down Strabane area, where transmission rates were reduced by 70%, and in my humble opinion, lives were saved. How that fits into his strategy that he's maybe outlining today?
I thank the member for his comments, but I would say that while he specifically makes reference to the restrictions in Londonderry and Strabane, that was indeed a targeted approach in which I support if the evidence is clear that action must happen. What I do not support is blanket restrictions across an entire sector or industry where we can, in fact, through test, trace and isolate and through the data that our scientists, etc., are collecting, we can look at more specific targeted solutions to deal with the COVID outbreak, wherever it may be. You talk about lives being saved as a result of the executive's actions, and I have no doubt that perhaps is the case in many of the circumstances in which you outline. But what I will also say is that there is also lives lost as a result of restrictions put in place. I look at suicide, as I know the member has taken a strong interest in that throughout his time in this place. There is people suffering from adverse mental health. There is also those within, not just at this time, I will in a later point. There is other issues in relation to those that have missed appointments in relation to cancer and to other such serious illnesses. And unfortunately, there is lives that will be lost as a result of the lockdown measures that are put in place. I said this clearly before, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I'll say it again. COVID kills, we have no doubt of that, but lockdown can kill also. I also want to make reference to a point, and I've outlined this. I had my concerns of the restrictions that were put in place at the time. I know other members did. I've outlined the business community that had concerns for their livelihood. But it is also important to note that there's indeed medical professionals out there that also do not agree with the strategy of lockdown. And I want to make reference to the note we all received, and I think it received some media publicity today, where four clinicians wrote collectively in a letter to us all, "We believe that the widely publicised call in the local media to keep the hospitality industry closed are not founded on evidence-based medicine, and that a measured and mature debate on their implementation is required." That goes to the heart of our democracy, and these are the points that I really want to get on to today. COVID has wreaked havoc on the democratic processes, not only in this assembly, but on democracies across the world. We are seeing a need to balance speed of action from executive ministers in relation to targeted intervention where that may be required, and also curtailing public debate on these very important issues. I think we can all agree, any restriction, no matter how vain it may feel to some members, has a massive impact on day-to-day lives. And the scrutiny that these regulations, and this is why I think I said it at the Health Committee, at my first Health Committee last week, the public will be as bewildered as I am that here we are, because of the mechanisms within this House, here we are some 3 weeks in, some 4 days before these regulations come out of place, that here we are only debating them in this House now. And I think that is something that I would like to see addressed by the Junior Minister here today. I noted at the Health Committee, it was actually the member for South Down, Mr McGrath, who did bring forward a suggestion at the committee, and a unanimous suggestion, that we write to both the First and Deputy First Minister and indeed the Executive to look at alternative ways in which this House can give these regulations the scrutiny that they deserve. And I think every member in this House would agree with that. But we can't have a have-your-cake-and-eat-it approach either. You know, on one hand, and I listened to Mr McGrath saying this earlier, on one hand he was calling for a full and proper scrutiny of these regulations. 100%, I'm with him on that and I agree with him. But on the other hand, he was saying that anybody that dares speak against or not agree with the approach adopted by the Chief Medical or Chief Scientific Officer is in direct violation of what the regulations are. That is not true, because we have heard from the radio this morning, and indeed our airwaves across the world, there is scientists, there is doctors out there in the world that look at different approaches, and it's only right and proper that we, the members of this House, give that due consideration. At the committee, the clerk was informing us when we were discussing this vital lack of transparency in relation to being able to really home in on the regulations. We discussed the fact being that because the regulations were laid in the way that they were, that there was no consultation, no stakeholder engagement. We, the politicians, have become that stakeholder. And it is vital that whatever direction of travel this executive take, that this assembly is given its place and given the opportunity to not only question but scrutinise the evidence presented. Because there is many questions that come from the data in which we receive. And I know I speak for a lot of people within close contact services, and I think of beauticians and hairdressers that were forced to close their doors. I think members across this chamber will agree with me. If there was anybody that was abiding by regulations, that had invested money and time to put the practices in place to ensure a safe environment, it was those industries. But yet, because of the blanket approach that was applied to these regulations, they were all forced to close. And sadly, the financial assistance which was promised to them has been slow. And that's through no fault of their own, but they were promised the support. And it is important that we, as an executive and an assembly, stand by our word and support those people in these difficult times. I also want to bear reference to the likes of driving tests. How many young people have contacted us in the days since lockdown began, frustrated that their lives are on hold because of something as basic and as fundamental to their freedom as that of a driving test? There was good news. Things had started to get moving again, albeit the backlog in the system. But now, because of the regulations that were passed, we have a situation where those young people still cannot pass their driving tests and start to contribute to society and maybe contribute to their households in terms of household bills, etc., that they can't do at the moment because of the regulations that are in place. And I would implore the Infrastructure Minister to bring forward a plan to see driving tests as a whole implemented across Northern Ireland and ensure that those young people can be dealt with as soon as possible. I also want to look now, and I've mentioned this at the committee, I have to say, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and the chair of the committee actually touched on this in his own remarks, I was shocked when I went to the health committee to hear officials, health officials, come to the committee who couldn't even answer the most basic of questions about how these regulations pertain to everyday lives. And they weren't questions, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that were off the wall. There were questions that were trawled through the media for weeks. And when the simple questions were asked, they could not answer. And, Mr. Speaker, it was simple questions from the committee, such as the evidence base for the introduction of all the rules. As we are now 2 weeks into the four-week period of restrictions, how well the department assesses the restrictions imposed to working to reduce the spread of transmission. Simple questions around compliance and enforcement information, they simply weren't forthcoming. And I think that's a damning indictment that while we curtail this parliamentary scrutiny in this House, that when it comes to committees, a committee such as the Health Committee, when basic questions are asked 2 weeks in and there still is no clarity or no answer, in fact, they were just forthcoming on Friday before this debate. I don't think that's acceptable. And I don't think it's a level of scrutiny that anybody could stand over. The scrutiny of the science as well. These regulations that were brought into place, but the data and evidence that supported their closure came after calls in this Assembly for the data to be released. It should have been the other way around. It should have been first, so people could make an informed decision about why this is affecting my life in the way that it is. I think these are basic principles which the executive need to take into consideration as we go forward in trying to fight this virus. I also want to talk about, and maybe the junior minister can elaborate on, the exit strategy. Because if it is a case that it's lockdown and repeat until a vaccine comes, I worry for the state of this economy. I worry for the livelihoods of everyday people across this province and indeed across the country. Because each time we take decisions to place restrictions on certain sectors and certain individuals, we run the risk of those businesses never returning again. I had a constituent, Mr. Deputy Speaker, on the phone to me on Thursday past in deep hysterics. You've asked me to close my business. You've told me that financial support will be forthcoming. Here I am, 2.5 weeks into the regulations, and I don't know how I can pay my mortgage for bills. I have 4 children to feed. I don't know how I'm going to feed them. So all of the talk in the media about restrictions on how they can help in terms of bringing our rate down must be looked through the line of balance as to the approach. And that's why I said it at the committee and I said here, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I do not think it appropriate for the Chief Medical Officer, and as much respect as I hold him in, and that is very high, I do not think it appropriate for the Chief Medical Officer to go on the airwaves and talk about one sector cannot open unless the other sector closes, and that being hospitality and indeed education. Because what that simply did, whether intentional or not, was drive communities against one another, different sectors of our society against one another. That is not a strategy in which I believe this House should be endorsing. We should see the evidence. We should discuss it and debate it within this institution. And we should go forward with a cohesive plan. Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I will say it in closing about non-COVID patients. I think this is an issue that is really starting to come home to a lot of members across the chamber and indeed the people of Northern Ireland, because every restriction has a consequence and some of them are more hidden than others. And I ask the Health Minister how the needs of hundreds of non-COVID patients across Northern Ireland who would currently be in hospital but are not due to the pandemic are being met. Since the middle of October, the number of hospital beds occupied by patients with non-COVID illness has dropped dramatically by between some 800 and 900 bed in total. This is according to the Department of Health's own dashboard, and I'm keen to hear, maybe the junior minister can, or maybe the health minister, who's maybe listening from another place, the assessment of the scale of this problem and whether patients may be at risk of tragically passing away because inpatient care wasn't available. Ultimately, Mr. Deputy Speaker, nobody should be turned away regardless if they have or if they're coming to hospital from urgent, planned, COVID or non-COVID service or care. The Minister claims that this simply isn't feasible in the current climate. However, I would again urge him and his officials to explore all options to expand the health service workforce. We have a duty of care to those people, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and the challenge now facing the Department of Health is to demonstrate what has driven this outcome and how the restrictions that are put in place in the data can actually justify the actions that were taken. Households and businesses have had to make great sacrifices. Their consent and cooperation should never be taken for granted, but earned and respected by we, the politicians. That means scaling up the evidence base for every rule and regulation and rationally setting out why they were necessary. In the past three weeks, more scientific evidence has been published indicating transmission risks in various settings. For sectors like close retail, as I have outlined, these figures don't alone stack up to wholesale closure. The duty is on ministers to account for this moving forward. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Pat Sheehan.
That's the last count, Corla, and has been stated on numerous occasions here in this debate. We're talking about regulations that have already been implemented, and a number of those regulations deal with the wearing of face coverings or face masks, whatever you want to call them. And I'm sure the junior minister will recall that I raised this issue on a number of occasions in previous debates in this chamber. And the evidence around face masks has been compelling for quite some time now. Indeed, the Chief Scientific Officer, when he was in the Health Committee a couple of months ago, said that he was concerned, and this was before the introduction of these regulations, that he was concerned when he went into a shop and discovered that he was the only one wearing a face mask. And he appeared on Good Morning Ulster a few days after that and stated that there was considerable evidence that the wearing of face masks reduces significantly the transmission of this virus. One thing I have noticed about the countries that have been most successful in suppressing this virus is that they're the countries that have moved quickly. They haven't waited for absolute 100% solid concrete evidence. They have moved quickly. It's the countries that have a culture of wearing face masks in the main that have been the countries that have been most successful in dealing with this virus. And they didn't wait on 100% solid concrete evidence before they did that. But there was evidence, and there was compelling evidence, that the wearing of masks reduces the transmission of this virus. And we waited, and we waited longer than we should have, and we should have moved quicker. And that should maybe be a lesson to us when we go to make other decisions about what will be useful in the fight against this virus. The other regulations that have been introduced are draconian, as have most of the regulations that have been introduced here over the last number of months. And of course, under normal circumstances, we wouldn't be introducing legislation like this. So why do we need these restrictions? That's the question that people are asking. And quite simply, we need them because if we don't have them, our health and social care system is going to be overrun. Now, I heard Jonathan Buckley saying that COVID kills, but lockdowns can kill also. It's not the lockdowns that are killing. It's the fact that our health service hasn't the capacity. It didn't have the capacity in the first place to deal with all the diseases and conditions that existed out there. Our waiting lists were already far, far too long. And then we have layered on top of that this pandemic, which is killing people, which is leading people into serious illness and leaving others with long-term conditions as a result of this disease. And how have we ended up in that situation? Why are we in a situation where our health and social care system hasn't the capacity to deal with what's coming at us in this pandemic? Well, it's because there's been years of underfunding of our health system, and there's a direct causal connection between that lack of investment and underfunding and the lack of capacity that exists within our health and social care system currently to deal with this pandemic. It's not rocket science. We haven't got the capacity. And we need to introduce measures, draconian though they may be, to ensure that the system isn't completely overrun. And I mean, I agree, there are people dying from cardiovascular disease, from cancer, and from other diseases who can't get the proper and requisite treatment as a result of what's happening with this virus and the fact that our health service is being overrun. Because the fact is, if people are seriously ill with COVID, they have to be hospitalised. If people are seriously ill with cancer, they also have to be hospitalised, or cardiovascular disease, or whatever. And the capacity isn't there. So, some people will argue, well, we should have built up the capacity in the hospital system. That can't be done overnight. We're in the position we're in because of years of underinvestment, and we're not going to fix it overnight. So we need some sort of alternative. And what these restrictions do is that they give us a bit of breathing space. They ensure that the health and social care system doesn't collapse on us. The people, the most seriously ill, can still get treated. And the transmission of the virus is reduced within society and within our communities. And I have some sympathy for those who oppose the lockdowns. I have some suspicions too, because among those who are opposing lockdowns are the science deniers and the crackpots and so on. You know, none of us want any sort of lockdowns. None of us want to live under these conditions that we've had to live under for the past 7 or 8 months. Who in their right minds would want to live in this situation? But is there an alternative? Is there an alternative to these types of draconian pieces of legislation, you know, that mean people can't have the normal wedding that they normally have, to go and visit their families, to visit relatives in care homes or in hospital and so on. Is there any sort of alternative? And I believe there is. And what we need to do is look at international best practice. And I already gave the example of the face masks. And among those countries that have been most successful in tackling this virus have been the Eastern Asian countries, Vietnam, South Korea, Hong Kong, Taiwan. Combined population of 178.5 million people. How many deaths have there been? Total combined, 629. That's fewer people than have died here in a population of 1.5 million. Why is that? What are they doing right that we aren't doing? What can we learn from them? And I asked the chief social worker at the committee a couple of weeks ago if there had been any direct contact by the department with any of those countries to find out what it is they're doing that we could learn from. And the answer was no, there hadn't been any contact. And I'm not suggesting for one second that we're, you know, exactly the same as any of those countries. Of course we're not, and of course there are differences. But I also remember at the very outset of this pandemic that we were being told about the lockdown in China, in Wuhan in particular. And commentators were saying, there's no way this would be acceptable here because we're a democratic country and China is an authoritarian country. So we couldn't have a lockdown like that. And lo and behold, we did have a lockdown. And it did what it was intended to do. Unfortunately, we didn't use the time to try and prepare for a second wave of this virus. And we're in a very difficult situation at the minute. And I spoke here maybe 5 or 6 weeks ago when the minister, the health minister, was responding. And I raised the issue of our contact tracing system. And I told him at the time that it was insufficient and that with the upsurge in numbers of people contracting the virus, it wasn't going to cut the mustard. And not long after that, the chief executive of the PHA, who have responsibility for contact tracing, was in the committee. And she said there were 151 people involved in contact tracing. And when I asked what did that amount to in full-time equivalents, she couldn't give an answer, or she wouldn't give an answer. I'm not sure which. But it has since transpired that there are 88 full-time equivalents. Now, do the sums, because at that point when the PHA were given evidence to the committee, the rate of transmission was in around 1,000 cases a day. 1,000 cases a day. And what the European Centre for Disease Prevention and Control say that in a lockdown situation, you can expect each positive case to have had 2 to 3 contacts. Outside of a lockdown situation, that number raises to between 7 and 20. So do the sums. Let's take an average, say each positive case had 10 contacts. That means 10,000 cases that need, 10,000 people that need to be traced in one day. Somebody explain to me how 88 people can do that. The sums just don't add up. And just by coincidence, The following day, there was an article in the Irish Times about the contact tracing system in the south. And some were saying it had been overrun the previous weekend. Others were saying it hadn't been overrun, it was understaffed. That was the problem. And Professor Sam McConkie, who's a consultant in infectious diseases, originally from this parish, but he's one of the universities in Dublin, he benchmarked the system in the south with Wuhan in China. And he estimated that the south need 2,500 contact tracers to have a proper, efficient system to track and trace all who have been in contact with positive cases. And if you extrapolate from that, then we need around 1,000. And what have we got? 88. According to the ECDC again, it takes between 4 and 20 hours to train a contact tracer. The topics covered: disease epidemiology, the contact tracing process, how to conduct interviews, practical examples and exercises, and data protection issues. Why are we not taking 1,000 people off the dole queues and training them to contact trace and put in place a proper system of find, test, trace, isolate, and support? What do we mean by find? Well, the only way you get a test here is if you have symptoms. Yet it's estimated that up to 60% of people don't have symptoms at all. How do we find them? We find them by mass testing. And I welcome the announcement by the Chief Scientific Advisor and more recently the Minister himself to say that there is a possibility in the coming weeks that capacity may be there to carry out mass testing in a way that hasn't happened thus far. So we need to find those who have the virus and isolate them and then support them. Because if they live in a house of multiple occupancy, for example, how can they isolate in that context? They need to have support from the powers that be, whether it's, you know, the department or the executive or whoever takes over a hotel, as happened at the start of this pandemic, when one of the hotels in the centre of Belfast was taken over, so that people can isolate and that they have support and that there's a system in place. If people need somebody to go to the shop and get their messages, then there's somebody there to do that. If they need financial support, it's there as well.
Order, and that's order. I have shown great latitude in allowing people to extensively discuss the matter, but can I draw the member back to the specific pieces of regulation that we're here to debate today? We are showing flexibility in the Speaker's role here, but we do need members to refer to the legislation which is being sought approval of today. Mr. Sheehan.
Corbyn, I've got last Cian Corda, and thanks for that advice. And of course, it's the legislation that we're discussing. It's the restrictions on gatherings, on going into other people's houses, on weddings and funerals, and all the rest of it. And collectively, it's all being described as lockdown. And okay, I accept it's not a lockdown in the true sense of the word, but that's the way it is being described. And I have tried to outline the type of system that we could put in place that would be an alternative to those restrictions, that society and the economy could carry on very much as normal, as is happening in South Korea and Vietnam, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and so on. And so in a sense, there's agreement. I'm in agreement to an extent with Jonathan Buckley. I don't want a lockdown. Jonathan doesn't want a lockdown. Let's think of some other way of tackling this. And let's look to international best practice, because others have been much more successful than we have been. Colonel Margaret.
I call Gary Middleton.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak in this, and I thank Minister Lyons for being with us and giving us some clarity, and hopefully we'll hear more from him later in terms of some of the questions that have been raised. Like many others, I am mindful of the fact that these regulations we're currently living with them, so it can be quite difficult at times having to, I suppose, give an evaluation of maybe how they have worked. But also, of course, there's many in the public domain who will look to us and maybe try and give some guidance in terms of how we go forward. But I think we need to be mindful that today and the vote today, if there is to be one, is specifically on what has already been put in place. In terms of the wearing of the face masks, you know, the tightening up of the regulations regarding to those, the clarity that that brought, particularly to our restaurants, our cafes, our bars, our taxis, our buses, those types of things, that was welcome, because many of those in those industries wanted that clarity. They didn't want to get into an argument with somebody who got into a taxi and wasn't wearing a face mask because it specifically wasn't in legislation to say that they had to do so. So that clarity was very much welcome. And I think that I suppose the importance of that messaging as well, it has increased the level of compliance right across our communities, because at one point over this past number of weeks, I know all of us would have said that it was worrying when you went into shops and you went into various places that the guard did seem to slip in terms of members of the public who were wearing face masks. So I think that message has finally got across to the public once and for all. In terms of Amendment number 8, it relates to the regulations that were brought in within my own constituency in the wider Londonderry and Strabane area. Obviously, the context at the time when that was brought in was at a time when the infection rate within our area was several times the Northern Ireland average, but actually at one point it was the highest within the United Kingdom. So I think there was a broad recognition that the status quo couldn't continue, something had to be done. And I think that the executive at that time, whilst it was disappointing that it had to be done, the executive was right to step in and take action. And thankfully today, when we hear some of the news reports and some of the data that's been talked about, we have seen a 70% reduction in that infection rate. And it was down to the fact that the communities, the businesses, did rally around together. They listened to that message. Now, we can debate around which specific restrictions worked and which didn't, but the fact is that the infection rate came down, and that was the ultimate goal, and we need to ensure that we continue to keep going in that direction. Obviously, from a business and an employer perspective, it did come as a blow. We know the hospitality sector, particularly, who had put in a lot of work in terms of this amendment. The hospitality sector put in a lot of work to get PPE in place to make their premises as secure as possible, and then to find out you have to close your doors. It did come as a blow, and that's why it was important, and we've always said all along that where this executive or this assembly closes a business, it's important that the support packages are in place. And at that time, I was on the record in various news outlets when I spoke about that localised restriction support scheme brought forward with the Finance Minister. I did say that I didn't feel that it was enough. It just was not sufficient. You know, that lower end talked about £400 for those with 15k NAV and below, and it scaled up. Now, thankfully, and I'm not putting it down to me, although if people want to do that, they can, that was doubled. And that was rolled out across Northern Ireland, and that is welcome. But like other members, we need to ensure that money, regardless of what department it comes from, we need to ensure that money gets out as quickly as possible to those who need it and those who most certainly require it. So I do welcome that. In terms of amendments number 9 and number 10, again, it tightened up a lot of the gaps. There's a lot of varying views right across the chamber in terms of the way we go forward. I think there's a collective position, if you like, that we would rather we were not in a position where we had to shut anything down. I think that, you know, we need to get to a point where we can coexist alongside the virus. We need to get to a point where we're not switching our economy on and off. We heard just a few moments ago from the economy minister when she said that the four-week restrictions in place cost our economy in Northern Ireland £400 million. Now, that's a devastating blow to the economy. Absolutely, we have to point to the fact that our priority should be about saving lives, but we also have to look at the evidence and the science. And Mr. Sheehan has left the chamber and he talked about science deniers, but for many businesses out there, it's not a case of denying. It's a fact that they want to see the science. They want to be assured that when I shut my hair salon or my beauty parlour, that's making a difference, and that there's a genuine reason for why I need to close my doors. I will indeed.
On that point, and I agree with the vein that he's on. Would he agree with me that one of the most frustrating parts of the evidence that has been supplied by Chief Scientific Officer and others is that it is modelling based on behaviour as opposed to actual transmission and infection rates within those settings that he talked about? Because if we look at an example such as hair salons or beauty therapists, etc., those that have put the measures in place to safely admit their clientele, had no cases, they had no transmission rate, but yet because of a behaviour modelling approach, they were branded in as being the causes of potential transmission rates and forced to close.
Well, I do completely agree with that point, and that's why we need to get to a stage where we try and find another way. And I can only speak in terms of my own barbers, who I won't name in case he loses business. He, from my haircut, of course, and what they put in terms of PPE was exceptional. But he accepted at the same time, again, when the localised restrictions came in, that there needed to be something to be done. So this is not about criticising. The executive have a huge task in terms of trying to balance the health, and we hear from experts, like Dr. Tom Black, who I know and I respect in terms of his view. They have genuine concerns from a health perspective. But where we may differ is the fact that the economy minister brings to the table her concerns around the economy and the effect that will have, and the effect that subsequently that will have on the mental health of those who lose their jobs and their livelihoods. So all of that has to be taken in the round, but I think it is important going forward that we do recognise that we have to find another way to try and coexist with the virus. In terms of the amendment number 10, it did bring clarity in terms of the close contact. That was one of the frustrations at the time when the restrictions came in. We need clarity. We need to know who's the shut, who's the open, and I think that was welcome. In terms of, it brought clarity as well, I suppose, in terms of the worship and churches and face coverings, and I would welcome the junior minister, if you could give us some, if there's any indication in terms of, even for our places of worship, a bit of clarity around maybe where they sit in terms of going forward. Maybe you could elaborate on that. In terms of going forward, I think clarity is the key message that I've been getting from businesses within my constituency, both city centre and rural. They want that message to be clear. Obviously, the current restrictions come to an end at midnight on Thursday. People are asking me, cafes, can I order produce for the incoming days? People want to know, can they take bookings for beauty salons? We hear a lot of talk in the media, but again, it's important that this Assembly Chamber is given its place, that we get to hear and that we get to give our views on what has been brought forward. I think that's unanimous right across this chamber. Again, when we hear regularly from businesses, they do reiterate that message that we have to find a way of coexisting. My colleague, Mr. Buckley, spoke about Belfast Chamber. I know myself and others have engagement with Londonderry Chamber. And again, that concern around job losses. The furlough scheme has saved many jobs, and thankfully that's there. But again, that will come to an end at some point. We can't keep coming to this cliff edge and worrying about what we're going to do next. We do need that strategy. So it's just about getting that balance right. Like other members, I think in terms of the health service, and I do want to thank the health minister, because this is a difficult job. And I think it is. We shouldn't be getting ourselves into a position where we're pointing fingers and criticising. I think the health minister has a difficult job, but he is one minister. And we have lots of ministers in the executive, and that's where the executive can bring these issues in and debate them and come to a consensus position. And then there's onus on all of us, because there's five parties in this chamber who are sitting on the executive, and these are executive decisions. So when a decision is taken, as uncomfortable as it may be, I think it is important that we do unite around that message and ensure that we can go forward collectively. Just in closing, I do want to say to our health workers and to our key workers, thank you. I want to say thank you for all that you've done over this past number of months, but thank you as we go forward, because we are coming into a challenging time. We know that our waiting lists are increasing. We know that A&E people are queuing to get in through the doors. So we do appreciate that work, and we can't forget that those people are continuing to work day in, day out as we go forward. And in terms of our businesses, these are tough times, and I think that it's important that we send a message to those businesses within our constituencies that we as an Assembly will stand behind them, that we will continue to fight for their funding and for their support, and we want to ensure that as many people stay in employment as possible over the next couple of months. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Martina Anderson.
I'll ask Ken Collier. There's no doubt that the rate of COVID transmission in Derry and Strabane was alarming. It was out of control. And so these regulations before us today, they were vitally important to bring the virus down. And I want to acknowledge the people of Derry and Strabane, because when they were introduced, I said that I had confidence that our people would do what needed to be done. And they did respond, and they did react in such a manner, and they did curtail the transmission of the disease. And we were reminded when the restrictions were introduced, if we needed to be, that we are the people who carry the virus, and therefore we are the people who transmit it to one another. And thankfully, as I stand here today, it's good news to report in that 5 weeks on after the restrictions, that there has been a 70% reduction of COVID infections in Derry and Strabane. So that shows that the restrictions work. The restrictions are draconian. Who wants to introduce them? There's not one person in this chamber that wants people's civil liberties or their rights taken away. But when you hear how we were back then and where we're at now, it's very clear that it has worked. But it hasn't gone away, because we all know, or most of us know, someone who either ended up with the virus or self-isolating, or unfortunately ended up in Altney Gavin Hospital. And I'm thinking of my two friends, Maura and Neil, who are in ICU. And their families are distraught with worry. And they also can't get access into the hospital to see them. So I'm conscious about the appeal that was made from the Vice Chair of the Health Committee today, because it's important that we try to find a COVID-free pathway so that families can get in to visit their loved ones. And I want to say to those anti-masks, people who are sending and spreading nonsense, to stop sending me emails, because I, for one, don't want them. I don't want to hear that argument, because I support what was said, and I support what my colleague said, Pat Sheehan, about we acted too late at times, but we're thankfully we're there, about the wearing of face masks. And I support the need for us to wear them where we have to. When these restrictions were introduced, we know there were bars and there were restaurants and sole traders who were worried about their businesses and their livelihoods, and they're still worried. You know, we all talk to them, they contact us. Although I do believe that the emergency financial scheme that was quickly put into place by the Finance Minister, Conor Murphy, was welcome. However, and I would say it's not just in Derry and Strabane, it's probably all of the members in this chamber, but in Derry and Strabane, we're being contacted by people who are designated as the newly self-employed. And they have heard about when these restrictions were coming in, they heard that a financial scheme was going to be put in place to help them, and they've been waiting, and they've been waiting, and they're getting very frustrated, and they're still waiting. And I have to say, Minister, I mean, they heard from the Economy Minister that they are the people who fell through the cracks. But they also, Minister, I would like you to bring this back to your ministerial colleagues, that it's enough is enough. They've waited for far too long. And they need, you know, the Economy Minister needs to get moving to put such a financial package in place for the newly self-employed. And I hear today her saying, the Economy Minister saying, that she was bringing something forward to the executive this week. So I hope that is, I hope for all of those people in our constituency and other constituencies who have been dealing with these restrictions, and they've been dealing with this from March of this year, who've been desperately waiting on a package for March of this year. They don't want no more excuses. They don't want no more dilly-dallying. They're giving out to us all, each and every one of us, because they're absolutely disgusted and fed up with having waited as long as they have waited. And there should have been a scheme in place long before now. And I want to acknowledge the communication from the two junior ministers to us representatives in Derry and Strabane since these restrictions were introduced. You've nearly had regular weekly engagements with us, and that was very much appreciated. And I also want to put on record, I acknowledge the work was done by other ministers as well. Minister Conor Murphy, the Finance Minister, met more than once with the business stakeholders in Derry and Strabane. Minister, and I know you understand this and appreciate this, because we need to protect our frontline workers, which include our carers, especially those who are on low wages, which don't even still to this day qualify for statutory sick pay if they have to self-isolate. And we cannot keep telling people that they have to self-isolate and not provide them with some kind of financial support if their employers are not paying them sick pay. And whilst the discretionary grant that has been put in place by the Minister for Communities is very welcome, it's actually better than any other grant that's in place anywhere. But she also, the Community Minister also understands, because I've talked to her, if you have a partner that earns over 20,000 and you have 2, 3, 4, 5 or more children, you cannot apply for that discretionary support grant. So for all those carers that are out there, and maybe, you know, their partner earning more than 20,000, they're not getting any kind of financial support. So I know I'm not the only one in this chamber who has raised the valuable contribution that our carers make to people with dementia. And I mention people with dementia because NISRA information has clearly stated that dementia is the most common underlying condition associated with the deaths from this virus. And in talking to many carers and agency workers who are working flat out, who feel burnt out, many of them aren't getting a proper night's sleep. And they certainly don't feel, and they have never felt, that we were all in this together. COVID-19 and what these restrictions once again has done, I think it's laid bare the dire state of our social care. And whilst those who work in it go beyond the call of duty, you know, social care can be seen as the poor relation of the health service. And yet, you know, it's one of the most vitally important elements where people working in them are dealing with those that are most vulnerable in our society. And when these restrictions came in and we were saying to people about family gatherings and people couldn't come into one another's homes, and whilst carers were able to go in, we know that these restrictions had a detrimental effect for those, particularly the most vulnerable, particularly those with dementia that live in Derry and Strabane. And so, Minister, whilst these restrictions were necessary and they were supported, there needs to be also found a safe COVID pathway, just like the hospitals, for visiting family members in residential care homes. And I know it's something that the homes have been trying to facilitate, but it's one of those areas that we know is very traumatic for people. Minister, Aldingavan Hospital needs additional support to stop it getting to the point of being overwhelmed by the R rate every time it rises. Despite the news today that I said it's 70% of the COVID rate and the transmission, the community transmission is down, we also know that Aldingavan Hospital in Derry remains on red alert of its COVID surge plan. That's still its status as of today. So when the restrictions were introduced, Aldingavan Hospital repurposed Ward 21, which is a vital state-of-the-art, recently opened and much-needed orthopaedic service. Now, the time waiting for hip replacements or any other orthopaedic surgery that you need, the time that people have to, the waiting time is alarming. I have raised in this chamber about one constituent who's waited 5 years. Now, that's just not acceptable. But being in the EU has afforded quite a number of people to avail of the cross-border healthcare provision. And I personally know two people from Derry travelling to a hospital in the south of Ireland today for that healthcare provision. So when you talk about these restrictions and the orthopaedic service being closed as a consequence to Aldingavan Hospital being overwhelmed, people have had a pathway to try to get that service. But I suppose with the Brexit transition finishing in 52 days, people are worried. People are worried that we could be having further restrictions, that these restrictions that are still in place, that there'll be other restrictions, and therefore they're asking the question, what's going to happen to that kind of cross-border service? COVID is bad enough, and of course these restrictions have been tough. And when you layer Brexit on top of that, then you can understand why people are so deeply worried about where we're at now, the restrictions that are in place now, and possible other restrictions that will be put in place. It has been said here that we owe, without doubt, a debt of gratitude to our healthcare workers, who have been, without doubt, to the forefront of the fight against COVID-19. And whilst we once again face the very serious challenge that this deadly virus presents, there remains an onus on us to ensure that other vital services, and that's been mentioned here today, and I make reference to the orthopaedic service in Aldingavan Hospital, continues to operate at hospitals wherever they are, even when we're seeing a rise of this transmission. So when the restrictions are being put in place and we have services in the hospitals being curtailed as a consequence of that, then we need to seriously look at the support that's needed to our health service. There are many strands that are needed to pull this all together in order for these restrictions to be effective in the long term, and whilst also ensuring that Derry and its services, both public and private, are not, as Dr. Black has said, overwhelmed and brought to their knees. And as these restrictions show, there's no good COVID. There's no good coming out of it. But what we need to do is to work to build back better. Build back better should be our motto, to improve the quality of life for our citizens, to protect and enhance the environment, to reset the economy. And that means to tackle regional inequalities with ring fencing allocations and policies like what the Communities Ministers announced last week regarding the reintroduction.
Can I draw the member back to the regulations, please?
I am, because this is all part of the regulations, Chair. Because the regulations, I'm not challenging what you're saying.
Order. I am acting as Deputy Speaker, yeah, and I will determine if I think it is appropriate or not. Mr. Anderson.
Okay, I will apply these regulations to deprivation. Deprivation for those people that are living in Derry and Strabane. among the highest level of deprivation, and these restrictions that have been put in place and COVID-19, there's a correlation between deprivation and what happened in Derry and Strabane, and why we needed the interventions that we needed, and why the community transmission of this was so high. So I go back to saying about the need to ring fence resources, to allocate them where they are needed. In places like Derry, who have suffered, the people in it suffered from chronic and persistent levels of deprivation, and therefore we had the spike that we had, and we had these restrictions being put in place in that way. And I believe that that is the work. That is the work of the executive, the work of this assembly, and if we're going to build back better, then make sure we don't leave those people who have most been most deprived behind. Go Romini Margaret, thank you.
I call Cara Hunter.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Junior Minister for being present here today. I am glad today to have the opportunity to respond to these regulations as they continue to be the most pressing of issues. I would like to start my remarks today by paying tribute to all in society who have made many sacrifices over the past 8 tumultuous months. From frontline workers to single mothers and elderly grandparents, we have witnessed sacrifices from all backgrounds and all walks of life. With the wearing of face coverings, I would like to thank the public who have taken into consideration the safety of others and their own loved ones by continuing to wear face masks and washing their hands wherever necessary. Today, my party and I acknowledge the need for these regulations being placed into legislation. In the past number of weeks, I have had a number of outstanding concerns, however, including some that have been raised to me by my constituents. As we all know, mental health is a huge crisis here in Northern Ireland, and I am sure that the Junior Minister and all members of this House will share my concerns about the impact of mental health on all our constituents and that this pandemic and lockdown has had, especially now during the darker winter months. One deeply worrying fact regarding mental health support services is that earlier this year, in June, adult mental health services in the Western Trust, areas like Derry and Strabane that do face deprivation, it had 504 patients breaching the 9-week standard waiting time. So the average waiting time for mental health support services was 21 weeks. That's very, very alarming. And I agree with the member to my right that spoke earlier about COVID has truly revealed and further highlights how chronically underfunded that our health service really is. A survey on COVID-19 and mental health carried out by Queen's University earlier this year, raised previously in this chamber, showed that a third of people in the north meet the criteria for anxiety and depression, with 20% meeting the criteria for COVID-related PTSD. Looking forward, following the implementation of these restrictions that limit so much human social contact, one concern I have recently is, of course, of the student demographic. After speaking recently with representatives from student unions about these restrictions, they have voiced to me that given these unprecedented circumstances, we as a society, private institutions and beyond must change how we provide support for our young people throughout this time. Currently, 6 mental health counselling sessions are being offered by a university counsellor, but young people are being passed to other counselling services. Many students I have spoken to are greatly distressed as they are on the NHS waiting list, and depending on their trust area, specifically the Western Trust, they may not receive help till mid to late 2021. I am sure that this pandemic sadly shows no sign of disappearing and that these restrictions will be in place. Our young people will need more mental health support. Their social contact has been incredibly limited over the past 8 months, and so have their support networks. Whilst we must do everything that we can to protect ourselves and our loved ones from contacting the virus, including by adhering to the regulations of which we discuss here today, we must also ensure that as we do this, we must be prepared for the knock-on effects of this virus and the mental health impact of this pandemic in the months and years ahead for all of us who have experienced it. Understandably, the new realities of life during the pandemic have caused great distress and great anxiety, not least the separation from family and friends, the wearing of face coverings becoming the new normal, which is especially distressing for young children, and the fear of the virus with no apparent end in sight. A huge part of alleviating this anxiety, however, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is ensuring clear messaging of what is expected of us all. To conclude, Today we have learned the executive will discuss and consider plans for restaurants to potentially reopen without the sale of alcohol. This morning I have heard from several frustrated restaurant owners and business owners who feel they are not being listened to, and this would only force them and their livelihoods to close. In order to follow these guidelines correctly, I urge the executive to ensure that these guidelines must be communicated clearly and concisely, with most importantly the scientific reasoning at the forefront of the messaging to the public.
I call Alan Chambers.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Previous speakers have spoken of the unsatisfactory method that regulations like those being debated today are being brought through both the committee and the Assembly. Indeed, we're discussing a piece of legislation that has been operating since the 16th of October and that is due to run out at midnight this coming Thursday. Now, having expressed dissatisfaction at this situation, we must acknowledge that this is a pandemic being grappled with by democratic government forums in many countries right across the globe. It is an emergency and thus requires emergency and agile approaches to making rules and creating guidance designed to save lives. To delay to meet normal bureaucratic standards could cause more lives to be lost. I don't like this situation, but I would not wish that any demand from myself or my party to deliberately delay implementation of any regulations would result in any further loss of life. Perhaps when we overcome the many challenges that this virus has thrown at us, and maybe even new challenges, given the news coming out of Denmark, we can reflect on how we reacted and what lessons we can learn that might assist those coming behind us in future years in dealing with any future pandemics. Pat has told us about, and I can't argue with the figures, of how well a number of Asian countries have dealt with this particular virus. And I think that we have to acknowledge that they have the benefit of having dealt with SARS and many other deadly viruses, and they have learned their lessons from it. And that's why I think they have managed this particular virus maybe better than other countries.
Yep. Thanks to the member for giving way. And I mean, that's exactly my point, that these countries have vast experience of SARS, of MERS, swine flu, avian flu, all the rest of it. And they were prepared to, you know, put everything in place that was needed. In some of those countries, there were lockdowns. In others, there weren't. There were only localized lockdowns and so on. And what I'm saying is we're not the same as those countries, but we can certainly learn from them. Let's try and take the best examples of what the best practice that they have used to try and get our own situation under control. Thank you.
Maybe that is the, thank you for the intervention. Maybe that is the role of the World Health Organization, and perhaps they have been letting us down and maybe not sharing what they know about how Asian countries have dealt with viruses. Now, my colleague, Mr. Steve Aiken, spoke earlier about leaks emanating from within the executive. Now, whether this is political gamesmanship or an attempt to ingratiate themselves with members of the media, the people doing this are not serving the public interest and should reflect on how this will compromise confidence and trust within the executive. Reports presented and debates held should remain confidential in the first instance. I genuinely do not envy the members of the executive in their decision making at the present time, and I'm sure they're having quite a difficult time today and trying to come to some conclusions. If ever there was an occasion when it's almost impossible to please all the people all the time, it's right now. The decision-making task is not made any easier by ministers being lobbied through the media when they haven't even sat down to consider what should have been a confidential document. If a minister went straight to the media with a departmental report before submitting it to the executive, there would quite rightly be outrage Why would anyone else involved in the executive think it is clever to take it on themselves to pass someone else's report onto the media? A reference has been made today by a member on calling in the army to assist our fight against COVID. Indeed, the minister was asked by the member at the health committee last week about the same subject, and it is a fair question. The minister for health has informed this house many weeks ago that he would not hesitate to seek additional help wherever he could source it, as and when required. What the Army do well is in providing engineering and logistical support. To date, we have not required such help other than provision been provided by the military for a temporary mortuary accommodation at Kinnegar Kemp in Hollywood during the first surge that thankfully was not needed to be utilised. In relation to offering medical backup, it is a fact that around 75% of Army medical reservists are already involved in the battle against this virus in their day jobs in the NHS. In relation to the Army assisting in the track and trace and testing process, I would imagine, given the number of people out of work at the present time due to the virus, there should be an adequate pool of civilians, workers to do this work. All that said, I got back to what the Minister is on record as saying. He will not hesitate to call on military assistance should the need arise, and I would fully support him if this becomes necessary. The other issue that worries me and should worry this House is the undermining of the public health messaging in relation to this dreadful virus. Elected members, some who serve in another House, who should know better, have been guilty of this. There have been other examples even today of remarks that are not helpful. No matter what other experts who seem to enjoy taking part in local radio programmes, their input is not helpful. One wonders what their motivation is. The mental health champion has cautioned against highlighting the impact of the lockdowns on mental health. We need to respect that advice from the mental health champion. And Mr. Aiken reminded us that all decisions around lockdowns and regulations are collective decisions of the executive, of which the five main parties in this House are represented. Regulations made are not Robin Swan's regulations, as some people who should know better try to portray. And indeed, last week at the Health Committee, the two officials that were referred to, that were there to answer questions, one was actually representing the Finance Department. So this virus will not be defeated by petty party politicking, nor by the input of armchair experts, even those who actually have the benefit of letters after their name. The experts that really matter are our own Chief Medical Officer and the Chief Scientific Officer. My party have full confidence in these two gentlemen and their teams as they advise the Minister of Health and the executive on the best way forward.
I thank the member for giving way, and I understand his point in relation to the significance of the Chief Medical Officer and Scientific Officer and health officials. But would he not also accept, because of the radical speed in which we are putting these regulations through, that other voices do matter and should be given consideration? We had today four clinicians, leading clinicians in Northern Ireland, say that these regulations were not, as they seen it, in the best interests of defeating the virus. So it's important, albeit that these voices are, we as elected representatives must take cognizance of all the opinions and come to an informed decision.
No, I don't accept that. I think that the experts that we employ are the people that we need to listen to. I mean, is the member advocating that I should listen to the hundreds of emails that I've got from the crackpots telling me that this is some sort of a fascist takeover of Northern Ireland? I don't think so. I think the advice that I want to listen to is the cool advice and the professional advice of our Chief Medical Officer and our Chief Scientific Officer. And if this House has no confidence in those officers, then I presume there must be a method to change the employment situation in relation to that. Now, the other experts appear to like the sound of their own broadcast voices. I think should step back as their input at this time is certainly not helpful. And not all the members today, we could have all, I suppose, indulged in a bit of finger pointing, but I think it has been quite controlled in that sense. But those members who have been criticising the track and trace and face coverings and all the other aspects of what we're trying to do, or the executive is trying to do, and telling us that we need to do things better, do they actually realise that they're criticising their own executive ministers? Because this lockdown and all that goes with it is a policy endorsed by the entire executive. And all these regulations today that we're discussing are all supported by every member of the executive, or at least collectively supported. And also I've heard people today, I heard the minister, one of the ministers use this term, I've heard one of the members using this term about, we'll have to learn to live with the virus. But do they also mean by when they say that we have to start learning to die with the virus? You know, and I think that's an important point. And also, Jonathan mentioned earlier about the virus kills, the lockdown kills. But I think we have to acknowledge that lockdown saves lives. And I think there's evidence that it has helped to save lives. When we look at the figures in Strabane and Londonderry, we realise it does work. And also, Jonathan talked about, he worries about the economy, he worries about jobs, he worries about the mental health of people. What he omitted to say, and I'm sure it was just a slip of the tongue, was that he worries about the health of every citizen in Northern Ireland. Absolutely. I worry about the health of every citizen, and I know that Robin Swan worries about the health of every citizen, which is quite correct, because that's what his job is as Minister of Health, just as the Economy Minister has a job to do, the Finance Minister has a job to do, the Infrastructure Minister. Robin Swan is focused on one thing, and that is protecting the health of every citizen in Northern Ireland. And Pat talked about, quite rightly, about underfunding. It's not underfunding that has just occurred over the last 2, 3, 4 years. This has been underfunding that has gone on for tens of years. And this pandemic has been a wake-up call. It has shown us how close we are to disaster with our National Health Service when something like this pandemic has come along. So this pandemic has been a wake-up call. And the waiting lists for all the different treatments, which we know even before this virus came in, were the longest waiting lists for treatment in all of the United Kingdom. Those waiting lists were not caused by this pandemic. And when we talk about funding, who do we blame for that? Who do we blame for the underfunding of our National Health Service? I would think we don't have to look any further than this house to see where the decisions were made or decisions weren't made that perhaps would have given us a better and put the National Health Service in a better place than what it is now. And I know it's a very sensitive subject to talk about, you know, people who are waiting on treatment, people waiting on cancer treatment, people waiting on hip operations. It's shocking, absolutely shocking, that is happening. But put yourself in the place of a clinician standing at the hospital door, and he hasn't got an available bed in his hospital, and somebody presents at the front door of the hospital who can't draw breath because of this virus, dying with this virus. What does the clinician do? Does he say, I'm sorry, we don't have any beds, just go on home? No, he'll go into the hospital and he may have a patient who's waiting to have a hip replacement done the next morning, and he will send that patient home and he'll make that bed available for the patient that can't breathe because of the virus. Those are tough, tough decisions that are having to be made, but unfortunately they are having to be made.
And just to draw the number back to the regulations.
Just to go back, I'm just finished now, Mr. Speaker, to go back to underfunding. Let's stop talking about building bridges that are going to cost millions of pounds. Let's start focusing on making the National Health Service the best that we can make it, because the people who work in it are the best people and they need the best facilities that we can give them. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Sinead McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise in support of the regulations, but unsurprisingly, not the process. Firstly, I want to recognise that COVID-19 has sadly claimed over 1,000 lives locally, left many others with debilitating conditions, and put our healthcare workers under immense stress. Therefore, given the high rate of community transmission, it was undoubtedly necessary to act fast and implement the new measures. However, while I appreciate the unique situation that we find ourselves in, it really is unacceptable that we are debating these restrictions in the Chamber just days before they're due to expire. We are denied the opportunity to give it due scrutiny, which reduces the chances of accountability and risks eroding the public's trust. And we depend on that trust to get us through this pandemic. If the public do not trust us and our decisions, then they are much less likely to follow those restrictions, which then would render them totally ineffective and useless. These restrictions have had a huge impact upon individuals and they deserve proper scrutiny. I am sure that some people watching today are questioning what is the point of this debate even, and I can absolutely understand why they would. Unfortunately, there are conspiracy theorists who will seize on this lack of accountability and use it to justify their false claims that the pandemic is a hoax. We cannot be complicit in adding fuel to that fire. We must also ensure that our messaging is clear. Mixed messages have certainly muddied the water and left many of my own constituents feeling very frustrated. Most people want to stick by the rules, but it can be hard to navigate the different restrictions. We need clarity in policy making so that the public know what is expected of them and why. It is therefore concerning to hear the phrase living with the virus being bandied about. This is a highly infectious virus with devastating consequences for many. It is completely disingenuous to suggest that we simply start living with it instead of implementing a proper strategy that seeks to suppress the virus. There is no contradiction between the health of our people and the health of our economy. The solution for employers and employees is for Northern Ireland to deal effectively with this pandemic. In particular, this lies with the health, economy and finance departments. Members, I agree with my colleagues here, my legislative colleagues, Jonathan Buckley and Pat Sheenan. I think both of these have made points, albeit from a slightly different angle. But what I would say, it does mean that we need to get our test, trace to work effectively, and that we also need to speed up reforms in our National Health Service so that Northern Ireland has sufficient resources and capacity available to support our patients and enable them to recover. It is unacceptable that having 400 COVID patients brings our National Health Service to near breaking point. 400 patients has nearly floored our health service. That's a real difficulty that we will have to face into the future. We've got to fix it. We have seen Derry and Strabane that the restrictions on the activities have worked. The transmission rate has fallen, as colleagues have said, by 70% as a result of the recent restrictions. But we're not out of the woods. Derry and Athlone Hospital had 16 COVID-positive admissions this weekend. So that's a very high and significant number. So whilst the restrictions are improving things in my city and region, we certainly are not out of the woods yet. Some proposals, such as authorising restaurants to provide meals but without alcohol, are just silly. We have to give employers, employees and the wider public hope for the future, including for Christmas. Put yourself in the shoes of our healthcare workers who are sacrificing their mental and physical health to cope with rising hospitalisations. The phrase living with the virus offers no solutions and very little comfort. We need more than a vague soundbite to get through this crisis. I would like to emphasise the importance of having the necessary support measures promptly in place. While support schemes have been announced, we find ourselves in a farcical situation where the restrictions are due to end this week and some schemes haven't even started paying the money out. They haven't even opened up. We still don't know the specifics of Part B of the COVID restrictions business support scheme, and help for the previously excluded self-employed workers was announced many weeks ago, yet we have not heard a single bit of detail. This is unacceptable. Minister Lyons, as one constituent put it to me, it's the silence that's the real killer. The lack of communication, with no indication as to when payments will be issued, it makes it impossible for me to plan my business. The current delays are spreading fear and panic, making it a difficult time even more challenging for thousands of workers. Mr. Deputy Speaker, we need a plan. We need one that balances the support for our employers, for our employees, and for the health of our communities. I can't see it yet.
I call Robbie Butler.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. You caught me on the words there, but it's a pleasure to speak on this debate today. And I want to thank everybody so far that is engaged, because I do think whilst there are a number of different opinions on some of the strategy and how we go about this, we have to remember that we've now been talking about this for some months now, and it has been buying a bit of a flash, but those families that have suffered and are still suffering and that are going to suffer, it's imperative that we speak with one voice, that we aren't afraid to challenge each other. But when the message does go out, like the last contribution said, that we do have one voice, because really that's where the confidence needs to be. And when we look at these regulations, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we are talking about them latently. We are talking about them slightly too late, but I want to thank the Speaker for continually writing to the Executive to try and bring them here and encourage them here to lay these regulations as quickly as they can. And I do also want to put on record my thanks to the Executive Office for offering up the junior ministers, because I do think that adds to the quality of the message that's gone out, because we cannot be divided on this, guys. It is right and proper that each of the Executive Ministers and those with their different priorities give voice to that. But let's be honest about it. When we're talking about protecting and saving life, that is the priority. It takes precedence over everything. And yes, there is a case, and it's been made from both sides of the House with regard to finances and poverty and the pressures that are put under our businesses at this time. But we also have to give voice and give testament to those businesses that are speaking to us and saying, we really need help and we really want to open. But I don't want to open if my business is in any way a danger. Now, this has been raised about the evidence, and people have been calling for evidence and scientific evidence. That's okay. But when the evidence did come, I said, but that's not the right type of evidence. We want it in a different way, and we want it in a different fashion. Guys, we're not virologists. We're not scientists. We have to trust those that we have put into place. I want to thank Mr. Chambers for the point that he made, that either we trust our chief medical officer, we trust our chief scientific advisor, and they don't work on their own. They have offices. And yes, we have a letter from four consultants who have raised concerns, but I suspect that we have a number of 1,000 consultants in this country. Now, had it been signed by 1,000 consultants, I'd maybe be prepared to give it a little bit more light today. I want to... absolutely.
Would the member agree with me that the quest for evidence is not only to assess whether what was done was necessary, but whether what was done was enough? And I think we need to be very conscious here that we should take all the help and expertise and experience we can get from wherever around the world it comes, and stop this nonsense of trying to unpick the measures in relation to whether there's enough evidence. We are not an exemplar here, and we have plenty we can and should learn.
Yep, I don't disagree with what the member said. I mean, this is something that none of us have dealt with before. It's something that all of our friends and family are involved in. And when you embark on any journey such as this, it is important that numerous times you put your head up, you take a look around, you assess what is working and what's not working, and that you're agile. I don't see any conflict with anything that has been said here today. We all want the same outcome. So we do. Just looking at some of the regulations, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I want to just pay testament to the communities that we have here, because one of the biggest burdens has been the inability to spend time with our family and loved ones. And the Northern Irish personality is one where a lot of doors would normally be open in our streets and in our families, and we do, we're very hospitable within our families, and that has been ripped away from us for months now. And like many of you, members of my family, I haven't seen since the start of this pandemic. Thankfully, we have some technology. We can speak and we can maybe see each other. But it really is quite tough. And the case has been made, and rightly so, for the businesses who are struggling. But I think what needs to happen is the information and the finances need just to be expedited into their hands, because what actually cripples people is the unknown. I think that's what causes the most damage. It's when there's a void of information, when there is a void of financial assistance, when there's void of a promise, I think that is more catastrophic than when you know the answer. And collectively, I'm not going to point the finger at any minister, whether it's finance or economy, and roll in and just think that I'm going to protect my minister. These are executive regulations. And I actually think the executive, in most cases, have worked exceptionally well in their messaging. And you only need to look at the elections in America recently to see how divided a country that some of us admire can be. And actually, we have a complicated system here, but in some ways, we need to be proud of some of our achievements. But we do need to improve, and we do need to ensure that life safety is the number one issue. With regard to masks, and perhaps the junior minister might speak into this, one of the things that concerns me, and I've witnessed it when I'm travelling into to work this last few mornings, is when we see the school children, post-primary school children, gathering for buses. You can see that in great crowds and great numbers, they're standing in big numbers and they don't have masks on. And I know the direction is to wear masks on buses, but what can we do to encourage them, even when they're gathering at the bus stops? We've seen a remarkable response from our young people in this country. And we talk about them when we say we're worried about them, but in the round, they've been exceptional. And I think there needs to be, and instead of a draconian measure of pointing out what's not happening, and say, how do we fix that at those bus stops and those places to encourage them to pick up and to wear their masks? The other thing that was a conversation, I think maybe last week, it was with regard to our university students, and we've got Christmas fast approaching, and we've got a number of thousands of students either living here, who will have to go home. We've got students that need to come back here. I'll declare an interest, Mr. Deputy Speaker. My son is in Aberystwyth as we speak. So as a father who wants to see it on Christmas, I think that's something that's incumbent upon this legislature in conjunction with the other devolved nations to ensure that our students have that information as early as possible. And they do get back for Christmas. And I hope there's maybe something we can look at in there. And finally, I'm going to issue a challenge, and it's not a challenge for you guys. I have been going to church on Sundays. I'm a churchgoer. I love my church. What worried me last week was that I did read a letter from some church leaders in the UK to say that they were thinking of challenging the regulations across the water. I would call on them to not challenge the regulations. I would call on the church leaders to lead by example. Certainly any church that I'm involved in, I want them to lead by example with the New Testament teachings and say, love your neighbour, so protect your neighbour. And if the government have made a decision in terms of restrictions, well, do you know something? They've done it for your interest and the interest of your neighbours. So I don't know if the junior minister will speak to that, but that's certainly a challenge to the churches for me. Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker.
I call Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. I want to start with this notion of these four consultants who have come up with a different view, maybe a second opinion, we might call it, as it's in the field of the medical world. The question is it for this House to say, here is a letter from four people which contradicts the direction of travel we're going in, and therefore that justifies us perhaps taking a different turn? I'm not sure that it is. And let me declare, by the way, Mr. Speaker, I am somebody with cardiovascular issues which had to be dealt with in an acute hospital during COVID. And I was dealt with in a very timely and professional and empathetic manner, and I want to thank all the professionals. And the point is that I want to make that I think is relevant is that consultants no longer say to you, here's what you need to do, here's the procedure you must have. They will say to you, you have a condition. For example, I had a heart condition, which a pacemaker should sort out for you. But you have to make the decision that you want the pacemaker fitted. And then he said, you have another condition which could kill you. So if you have an internal defibrillator fitted, that should keep you alive if the condition kicks off until we get you into hospital. So they only tell you, here are your options. They don't tell you, this is what you have to do. And in the same way, four consultants say, we think we're taking the wrong tack. Is it not for the Minister of Health to speak to his chief medical officer and say, what about that opinion? It contradicts where you are. I need to be reassured by you that what you're telling me is the right thing and the right recommendation. And I'm sure it is for the Health Committee to test the Chief Medical Officer and the Minister for Health to say, are these four right, or are we sticking with our Chief Medical Officer? But I don't think it's for this House, and particularly those in this House who want to take a contrary view to the path we are on, to simply say, aha, here is a handy bit of evidence, a new letter from four people who call themselves consultants, because they are, so I will use that to justify my path. I don't think that's the right thing. I don't think that's the way scrutiny should work. We should test the minister. The minister should test the chief medical officer. The committee should test the CMO. We should be following the right medical and scientific advice. Mr. Sheehan made a good point that for at least 10 years, the health service has suffered from underinvestment. We have an Ulster Unionist minister today. 10 years ago, we had an Ulster Unionist minister. Michael McGimsey was able to forecast years ahead to within three decimal points in billions of pounds what the health service needed to stand still. And this House did not vote through that money. In fact, this House tortured Michael McGimsey, brought him back again and again and again for debates, making sure that he spent as much time here in the chamber, which means as little time as possible doing the job of being a minister in his office. Absolutely tortured him, but he was right, not least in terms of the finances. And let us also recall that 11 years ago, there was a global pandemic, swine flu, and Michael McGimsey was in charge. And what did he do? He ensured there was a vaccine for every citizen in this country. And what happened? It wasn't needed. We didn't need anything like a million vaccines. And what did this House do? Tortured him for wasting millions of pounds. But what if we'd needed it? And have we learned the lesson? I'm not sure we did, because I have been in this chamber this year when some have tried to torture the current health minister over the Nightingale hospitals because the beds weren't needed in the first wave. But what if they are needed? And I get the argument that you are taking resource and you're taking professionals out of their day care, their day job, and putting them into a Nightingale hospital where perhaps they're sitting unoccupied. But those are tensions we cannot resolve. Not if we want to be prepared for worst case scenarios.
Can I draw the member back to the restrictions which we're debating here today?
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I understand your desire. A couple more points then, if I may. Mr. Buckley and Mr. Middleton made points about the effects, particularly under Regulation 8, of the impact on businesses, including hospitality. I took a phone call upstairs in my office this morning from somebody. He didn't tell me who he was, except that he was a business person. I didn't ask his constituency or whether he voted or not, because those are not the important issues. The issue was, he said he had to close up his business in mid-March and he hasn't been able to reopen since. And he vacillates between frustration because he thinks we are useless and anger and despair because he thinks we are useless. And his point is, this is a second wave that we all knew was coming. So his question is, why did departments like the Department of the Economy not make sure they had their data sets in order? Make sure that they had their processing arrangements in order so that when they come up with a scheme to grant aid businesses, that it can be processed quickly and the money can be delivered. And that follows a very lengthy email I received yesterday, again with regard to Regulation 8. And it's with regard to hospitality in the Derry City and Strabane Council area. And they're making the point that they're now facing the sixth week of having received none of the financial help promised by the Finance Minister, the £400 to £600 per week that was promised. He says that the hospitality sector up around Derry was informed their claims would be dealt with first and that it would all be done in short order, 7 working days after they were notified that the money was to go in their accounts. But here they are, having been told they were successful in mid-October, still waiting for the money. Now, in fairness to the Finance Minister, I sent him an email last night and he's already responded to say that there have been difficulties in getting the right data out of some councils and that they're working on it, and he believes that the pipeline for grant aid is now open. And I thank him for doing that. But the point of this morning's caller remains, surely we should have ironed out all those data problems in advance. And given the pandemic may be with us for a very long time, and it may not just be a first and second wave, but there may be more to come, can I encourage the executive to do more to ensure that the data sets are in place so that the processes can be activated as quickly as possible? I thank you for allowing me some latitude, Deputy Speaker. But the point is, I think, that the health service needs to be supported not only in fighting COVID, but in preparing for the radical reforms that we need to best serve the health of the people of this country. And once again, I thank all those who have helped me in recent months with my cardiovascular issues. Thank you.
I call Pat Catney.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thanks everyone that's contributed here today. There's a lot I could agree with, there's a lot I can't agree with, but business isn't easy, folks. You all know that, because if it was easy, everybody would be at it. So, but we live in hard times and they're difficult times. Mr. Speaker, the whole point of having these regulations in statute, in fact, the main reason that we have our laws written down, is to provide clear instruction to our citizens and our businesses on what must be done, how it must be done, and when it must be done. Clear instructions so no one is disadvantaged or put under unnecessary duress. However, there has been no clarity in how we have got to the restrictions in this second lockdown. Yet again this week, we have had the First Minister saying that there will be no extension to the current restrictions. But we find out yesterday in a TV interview that that is probably not going to be the reality for a lot of businesses. How do we expect any business to survive in this environment? How do we look at those that run our supply chains, who need time to prepare for any reopening, and how are in limbo for another week, caught between the expense of preparation if there is an extension and the loss of income, or if there is not? What is particularly annoying is that this is exactly what happened when the executive first introduced this new set of restrictions. On the Monday, the Education Minister guaranteed that schools would not be closing. Questions had been asked for weeks about if the schools would be closing, with no answers. On Tuesday, they were told to close. Honesty is needed with the public, Mr. Speaker. Tell the public that a six-week lockdown now is a big step, but it would allow certainty that there could be some sort of relaxation to allow people to come together and businesses to open for the festive period. Surely this clear instruction, rather than the political spin we have got over the last few weeks, would have given us all a better standing with our business community. I applaud the vast majority of the public who have followed the restrictions over the last period and helped to get our infection numbers down from some of the worst in Europe. However, unrest exists due to the lack of clarity and the lack of decision-making based on scientific evidence. This will only grow if what has leaked this weekend turns out to be true. Shame on those, Mr. Speaker, that have leaked this information. So let me be absolutely clear. Show me the evidence that a restaurant that serves a bottle of wine with dinner is more dangerous than a restaurant that doesn't. Maybe I am wrong, but that sounds less like the decision-making based on evidence and more like decision-making based on outdated conservative prejudices against alcohol that this chamber spoke so strongly against last week. It is a nonsense to suggest that restaurants should open, denying their access to the support schemes for businesses asked to close. But they should not sell alcohol, which is critical to their business model. When this executive asks any service to close, whether it's schools, restaurants or retail, it needs to provide additional support to allow people to follow those rules. The slow pace of support to date has not inspired confidence. Before deciding the way forward, the executive should take advice from the president-elect and the first female vice president-elect of the United States. Now is the time for science and a time for truth. That is how we build trust with our business community. That's how we can support them, and that's how we get through this pandemic. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Jim Allister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. It has to be said there's something inherently farcical about this debate, in the sense that we are debating regulations. The first one, number 8, already superseded. Number 9, about to run out in 3 days. And yet, this is the opportunity for the Assembly to say whether it consents or not to horses that have already bolted in terms of legislation. So there is something inherently farcical about that. And it's not just within the mechanics of that that the farce exists. Take you back to Regulation 9, regulation which we may all recall hanging about this building. I think it was 3 weeks ago tomorrow, or was it 4 weeks, on a Tuesday evening, being told that we were waiting with bated breath an announcement from an executive. It was coming at 5 o'clock, then it was coming at 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, and at 11 o'clock we were told to go home. Why? Because again, the dysfunctionalism ruled. And when the regulation did come the next day, we were told, of course, it was coming into effect at 6 o'clock on the Friday. And businesses, in good faith, prepared to close at 6 o'clock. A whole evening of trading was lost in the hospitality industry. But when did the regulation come? It wasn't made till 10:30 that night. And meanwhile, we had a sports minister who was intervening to tell sports fans at Coleraine to go home. They couldn't get into the ground under a law which hadn't even been made. And when it was made, didn't even say that. Never said that. Had the Pacific exemption in respect of elite sports, which never was in the business of banning a limited number of spectators. That is the background of farce and incoherence, which speaks to many people in terms of the level of confidence they should exercise in respect of these executive measures. And that is a contributor, amongst other contributors, to the loss of confidence amongst many in the public as to the regulations made. That's unfortunate, and that is potentially damaging and dangerous, because COVID is real. We all have our own personal responsibilities to obey regulations and to take upon ourselves that personal responsibility. But when an executive behaves in that incoherent way, then of course it is easy for people who want to depart from regulations to find that route. So those are the reasons why I say there's something inherently farcical about debating these matters at this stage. But it is important nonetheless to do it, because we are still in the climate of this virus where, frankly, we do not really know what the direction of travel is. You know, with the First Minister no later than last week telling us that which was forbidden in Regulation Amendment 9 comes to an end at midnight on Thursday. Then we had the Deputy First Minister telling us yesterday, well, that's only partially true, because some of it is going to open up, but some of it isn't, and we're now going to have new ideas about restaurants open without the capacity to serve alcohol. Mr. Catney depicted that as some sort of fallout over a view about alcohol. I think, frankly, it's more likely to be the typical horse trade of this executive rather than anything else. But I agree, it's illogical. It makes no sense. Sure.
Maybe you can help me, Mr. Speaker, or Deputy Speaker. The executive, I was told, was going to meet on Thursday. They didn't meet. I was told that they were going to meet today. And that's why we're debating in this House. I hope the member agrees with me. We haven't got any direction from them. And it's the two larger parties, from what I can see, Sinn Féin and the DUP, that is holding this whole process back at the moment. Because I don't think all of the executive has met yet.
I don't know whether they've met today or not. I don't know whether we're going to hold our breath for some announcement tonight. Who knows? But I do know this, that this is an executive that has not addressed issues that they ought to have addressed post phase one of COVID. Let's take the issue of care homes. Care homes were devastated by COVID in the first wave. And yet today, we're back at the point where there are 139 outbreaks in our care homes. And why would that be? Well, I respectfully suggest one of the reasons for that might be that up until last week, we were only testing staff in care homes every 2 weeks. Last week, the minister announced we're now going to do it once a week. Well, given that care homes are effectively closed down to visitors, it is quite clear to anyone that the entry point for COVID has to come unwittingly through the staff. So why is it that staff would not be tested every day, or at least every other day? What lesson was learned out of the first phase that suddenly, multiple months later, we're only now starting to talk about upping the testing in care homes. And I don't think once a week is enough. It's better than every 2 weeks. But I think, again, knowing that that is where the highest level of fatalities will be amongst people of the age bracket who populate our care homes, it seems to me a gross neglect to have allowed that situation to again develop. So I do think that it's not just enough to say, oh, we must all rally behind the executive, they're doing their best. Sorry, there has to be the role and the opportunity for criticism. And that means that when four clinicians, who are not four busybodies, in fact, when four clinicians decide to swim against the tide, it's not an easy task, swimming against the tide. Some little experience of that myself, but it is not an easy task when you have the chief medical officer and you have the chief scientific officer and you have the minister and you have the head of the BMA all telling a particular theme. It's not a particularly easy course for four clinicians to put their name to a letter and say, well, in fact, is this right? To say, in fact, do we not need better evidence than what we've got? And it's no answer to those four clinicians to say, there's not 1,000 of them. If they're making a valid point, then the minister, the executive, should be looking at it and taking heed of it. Yes?
I thank the member for giving way. And would he agree with me that while many in this House call for more robust scrutiny, more conversations, more discussions in this place to discuss these regulations, that when opinions contrary to that of the Chief Medical Officer and Chief Scientific Officer come to the fore, they simply want to dismiss them offhand without giving them due consideration?
And I've given quite amount of flexibility to members. I would ask that members would come back to the regulations which we are here to discuss the legislation today. So please refer to the regulations.
Well, I'm discussing the regulations before us, including 8 and 9. 9 was brought in on the basis that the Chief Medical Officer said it had to be. The same Chief Medical Officer who a few days ago remarkably said that you couldn't have both hospitality and the schools open. And when a chief medical officer says that, and then you get four clinicians who write a sentence like this, then I think it is very germane to whether or not these regulations are on the money. And what did the four medical officers write? Well, amongst what they wrote was, to deprive our population of livelihood, civil liberties, and education, we believe that the evidence to support this should be scientifically robust and beyond reproach. Who could disagree with that? That before we do what we're doing, we need to be sure that what we have is scientifically robust and beyond reproach. And they go on to say, this is clearly not the case. Yes?
I'm grateful to the member for giving way, and I think what he is saying and the argument that he's driving at, it reminds me of the maxim of Harold Macmillan, who said that we have not overthrown the divine right of kings to fall down for the divine right of experts. Does the member agree with me that going forward, a much more robust interrogation of contrasting and competing points of view on these matters is going to be called for in order to ensure public confidence?
I do think that the public watching on, both to buttress their own confidence that they should believe all that they're told, have come to the point that they do recognise that essential to that confidence building is challenging. You know, it's easy to say, here is what we must do, But you cannot do that and ignore credible contentions. And if you have four clinicians of the standard of Dr. Walsh and his colleagues bravely saying there is clearly no evidence for what lies behind some of these measures, then I think it would be grossly irresponsible for this House to simply say, we don't want to listen to that. That doesn't suit. We're going to ignore that. And they say many other things in this letter which are important. And they do make the point that people are dying because of COVID, but not off COVID. People are dying because they're not getting the treatment for their other diseases. Every day in this country, 12 or 13 people will die of cancer. What will that figure be next year? Because of those who didn't get their diagnosis, who didn't get their tests, who had their treatment delayed? The House may remember I raised at the early stages of COVID with the Deputy First Minister in this House the tragic case of a young mother, aged 32, diagnosed with cancer, treatment paused. Now, after some time, the Minister, and I appreciate it, intervened and treatment was resumed. But the weeks that were lost, she weakened. And tragically, that young mother died a few weeks ago. Now, was she a casualty of COVID? How many casualties because of COVID will there be next year? Because, as Ms. McLaughlin said, we're in a situation where 400 cases has put our National Health Service in crisis. Really? And that brings me to Mr. Nesbitt's point. He's absolutely right. Some of this rundown in our health service was self-inflicted by the politics of this House. When Michael McGimpsey was Minister of Health and said he needed funds to keep us standing still, the greater political forces in this House mocked him, refused him, and forced upon him cuts, which to this very day we're bearing the consequences of. That was politics, not health. And in fact, in the last 10 years, this House has reduced the number of hospital beds in our community by 1,500. 1,500 less hospital beds than we had 10 years ago. And then we're surprised about not being able to deal with the pandemic, and the 400 cases put us in this spin. I think this House needs to take a look at itself as to why it did that and what it's going to do going forward. In the autumn of 2016, there was a national-wide pandemic dry run, as it were. The Minister of Health in Northern Ireland was our present Deputy First Minister. What lessons were learnt out of that? What preparations were made for pandemic?
Just the members insinuating that the health minister at the time of Operation Cygnus was in some way knowledgeable about the results or the report from that particular simulation of a pandemic. In fact, the details of it weren't made public until after she had left office. Gormaí Ogut.
I don't consider that to be a point of order, but your comment is on the record, Mr. Alistair.
Sure, Mr. Sheeran, I would never think or accuse the Deputy First Minister of being knowledgeable. But what were the preparations that were made for a pandemic such as this. The preparations of this House was to reduce the number of nurses, reduce the number of doctors, reduce the number of beds. That was the preparation made. And unless and until that is reversed, then we will not be in a fit position to meet what hopefully doesn't arise, namely future pandemics. But where are we going now? Regulation 9 came in. It expires on Thursday night. First Minister told us that's the end of it. And we were told if we get the R number under 1, then the regulation has served its purpose. But from what I've heard, the R number is significantly under 1. So why is there even a debate about continuing to strangle our economy with further regulations? Yes, it's very good to have all the support of the furlough scheme, and the generosity of that is considerable. But I must say, I do fear, how many zombie jobs are we sustaining? How many jobs will not be there when furlough ends, as it must end one day? That's part of the real challenge. And that is why the four doctors were right to say in this letter, the deprivation of livelihoods and extreme measures that are being called for seem very difficult to justify on the basis of the current clinical evidence, when the wider societal and health costs are also considered. We really must think again. And I echo that. I do really think we need to think again.
I call Jerry Carroll.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Once again, it is ridiculous and extreme that we're discussing these regulations in this chamber weeks after they are brought in. And whilst by all accounts there seems to be consensus among a majority, or certainly the big parties of the executive, to further lift restrictions and thus making these regulations effectively meaningless just weeks after their introduction, welcome to storm and making a decision where basic logic need not apply. Okay. I was going to try and guess the composure, but all that. We cannot have a situation, Mr. Deputy Speaker, in which the Westminster Parliament, hardly a bastion of democracy, has more accountability in its course of action than this House. Why is it, as others have said, we have to wait 3 weeks when regulations are brought in before we have the chance to discuss them? We are in a health pandemic that has already claimed the lives of over 1,000 people, and I give my sympathies to all their families who have lost a loved one. Why can't this House have emergency or extra sittings in the chamber to discuss these regulations in order to challenge or alter them? I'm sure, like others, when there's a change or a proposed change of the regulations, I'm inundated with questions from constituents about what's going on, what they mean for them, and so on and so forth. We should absolutely insist that ministers of the executive should bring these regulations before the House before they are implemented. Otherwise, we cannot say there's any serious scrutiny or accountability at play here. Is it because, Mr. Deputy Speaker, as was revealed in Sam McBride's book about the RHI scandal, that ministers are overtly sensitive from criticism and are in this instance running scared of it? Or is it because they don't want any scrutiny of their dangerous strategy of living with a killer virus like COVID? Mr. Speaker, Amendment 8 relates to the regulations and restrictions in the Derry Strabane area. It's worth remembering these restrictions on hospitality were brought in because cases had risen rapidly, and evidence shows they helped bring the infection rate down by a significant amount. We heard that the biggest proportion of cases in the Derry and Strabane area came from hospitality and then community transmission. Restrictions on workplaces are obviously not ideal, and not what anybody wants, not least workers themselves. But these restrictions are important. An important method in getting infection rates down, and as opposed to letting it spread rapidly across our community. And in the absence of this executive adopting a zero COVID approach, they are clearly still necessary. Amendment number 9, Mr. Deputy Speaker, implements restrictions on hospitality
and other sectors. Again, this situation arose after the executive moved too prematurely to lift restrictions at the end of the summer, precipitating the spread of COVID in a second wave. This move, alongside the abject failure to establish a proper track and trace system, has created this disastrous, uncertain situation where the executive have been forced to again put the hospitality sector into lockdown after lifting it too soon. That said, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I want to strongly contest the idea that now is the correct or safe time to open up hospitality or any other sector further to push people back into restaurants and other venues when this virus is still spreading and taking people with it. How many more lives will we put at risk and lost because people want to see, some people want to see in here, a laissez-faire capitalism run right over people's lives? Mr. Speaker, in this chamber, previously criticised DUP members for their approach to the virus, and obviously Mr. Sammy Wilson has been at it again. I think we need to urgently isolate the rotten politics of Sammy Wilson. But now, even Sinn Féin, or certainly the Deputy First Minister at least, seems to be dancing to a similar tune, when we have a whole range of medical experts warning against the reopening of hospitality and suggesting that an easing of the current restrictions would be dangerous and result in mayhem. The First and Deputy First Ministers seem to be taking a very different approach in the media this week. Very, very worrying indeed. I have to say, Mr. Speaker, it is quite astounding to see some quarters feigning concern for low-paid workers, despite not lifting a finger to support them or improve their conditions since dormant has sat. Is this a tough period for hospitality workers? Absolutely. Many workers in this industry are worried about their future and their livelihoods, but they're also terrified about this virus as well. And if people here are seriously concerned about these workers, then I appeal to them, I urge them to support the motion submitted by Rachel Woods and I last week in relation to the Unite Hospitality Rescue Plan. Last time I checked, the bigger parties haven't supported this motion, and it calls for a policy which would financially protect hospitality workers, adopt a proper testing system along with other important and achievable demands. But Mr. Speaker, we cannot look at a hospitality in isolation from how people may react to the change or rumoured change in restrictions, because people see, according to the executive logic, that it's safe to go into a restaurant, then they will also draw out the obvious contradiction that if it's fine to mix and socialise when you're spending money in a restaurant, then why not in their private lives? This executive needs to stop trying to effectively privatise social interaction by allowing people only to mix where they spend money, but then restricting and indeed potentially fining people for elements of their family lives. Mr. Speaker, my worry is that any efforts to reduce this virus in recent weeks will again be wasted if restrictions on workplaces are relaxed once again. And this is happening because our political establishment of both Westminster and Stormont are too tight-fisted to deliver the real provisions that need to be put in place to help workers and small businesses shield and protect themselves from COVID. Amendment number two, Mr. Deputy Speaker, in relation to face coverings. Repeatedly, several times I've raised the point that wearing a mask is an important act of solidarity for those in our health service, those in retail, supermarkets and so on and so forth. Again, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I repeat my call for this executive to urgently adopt. I've raised this with a number of ministers a number of times. Urgently adopt a position to provide free, reusable masks to the general public. If we are saying that masks are an important part of protecting people from this virus, and it is, then the executive needs to step up to the plate and support people in those endeavours. Finally, Mr. Deputy Speaker, this executive needs to radically shift from its dangerous policy of living with the virus and adopt the approach outlined by Independent Sage and others to adopt a zero COVID and elimination strategy. When you look at other countries adopting this approach and strategy, not only are there a low level of deaths, way beyond our astronomically high figures here, but these countries aren't going in and out of lockdown. These countries are living what could be considered normal, or relatively normal in this period, life, with people being able to go to large sporting events and other activities. The Stormont executive's living with COVID strategy is a disastrous one, which creates a false choice of health versus economy. But in reality, it delivers the worst of both these worlds by continually pitching people's health against their jobs. You can't keep sending people back to work unsafely before a proper track and trace system exists. For example, and the negative repercussions of this impact both on the individual workers as well as collectively on businesses and workplaces. If cities like Liverpool can implement mass testing of citizens and associate Belfast and across the north more generally. We need urgently, Mr. Speaker, to adopt a zero COVID strategy of elimination and control, not this constant stop-start of many lockdowns with seemingly no rhyme, reason or logic or long-term planning. Anything less means more deaths as well as job losses in the long run. The lack of vision towards this in the executive is astounding and increasingly appalling. Thank you.
And I call Christopher Salford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir. Listening to the previous speaker, I think it's probably important to note that pennies don't fall from heaven. They have to be earned here on earth. And the economy pays for everything that government can do. Without a strong and thriving economy, government cannot exist. And the services that we want to provide for our people do not exist. I think only the most economically illiterate would attempt to assert that we should continue to keep vast swathes of our economy under lockdown. And I don't envy ministers. At the start of this year, no one had heard of COVID. So they've been dealing with an extremely fluid and evolving situation. And they have to take advice. We have a chief medical officer and a chief scientific officer who are paid to give advice. But as this has progressed, I hope that there's a preparedness to maybe look outside government and take advice and other contrary opinions there. I want to speak about the hospitality sector in particular today. The hospitality sector, for many people, provides maybe a second job. And that few pounds that was coming in through a second job was maybe going to be paying for Christmas, paying for their kids' school uniforms, paying for things like that. The longer that those jobs don't exist or are not accessible, the more devastation and hardship is being heaped upon people. So, and I'm also mindful of the fact that decisions are being made, every single one of us in this room, our income will not be affected by the decisions that are made here because we're public sector workers. So it's easy for us to stand up as the previous speaker did and say, lock it down, lock it down, lock it down. Because it's not us who will be damaged economically in terms of our income by that approach. It's easy for us, sitting in a big white house on top of a big hill in Belfast, to tell people you can't go to work.
Given way, but just to be accurate, I didn't ever say lockdown, lockdown, lockdown. But would he raised concern about low-paid workers and hospitality workers as well. Like I've said repeatedly in this chamber, there's a plan in place from Unite Hospitality support workers and ensure their payments and jobs are protected in the future. Would he and his party support that motion and that plan?
You see, that's the difference. You can pass motions, as I know that his party has want to, in Belfast City Council quite a lot. You can pass motions that are a form of words, or you can actually use the levers of government to act. And the best way to act is to get the economy open as quickly as possible. Because, and I said this in March, because the cost of all of this is immense. We're running up huge debts that my children and possibly their children will be paying off as a consequence of this. There is no such thing as free money. This has to be paid back. And so, for the good of people, I'm pleased that there have been relaxations that have been announced in terms of the economy and allowing people to get back to work. And I would urge the government, the executive, to move as quickly as possible in that direction, because people need to be allowed to live, they need to be allowed to earn, they need to be allowed to support their families. I want to ask, and I don't know whether the minister will be in a position to tell me or not, and if he's not, that's fair enough. It would be useful for people to know what the R number presently is. Now, I wasn't in for the entirety of the debate, so I don't know whether that has been put into the public domain or not, but it would be useful if people knew that. Because if we're aiming towards a goal and we knew that it was well above one, if the minister was in a position to tell us, you know, it has fallen from where we thought it was and it'll keep falling if we do this, then I think that gives people something to aim for. I think that's been one of the problems, and I said earlier I don't envy ministers. Because the situation has been evolving so quickly, and because the regulations have had to be amended, you know, almost on a weekly basis, there is confusion out there, and I'm sure people accept that. One of the issues I absolutely do agree with Mr. Alistair about, I'm sure we have all had constituents who have had medical procedures cancelled or delayed, and it's devastating for people. Girl I grew up with, her mother went to the hospital in March and complained of pains in her stomach. They thought it might be her gallbladder. It turned out it was stomach cancer. And, you know, so it's well and good for us to be having abstract conversations, but there's real people out there suffering the real effects of all of this. And that's why I think it is important that we do move as quickly as possible in order to give our people the capacity to earn and support themselves, in order to give our government, through rates and tax, the capacity to deliver public services and reform. And I just want to finish on this point. There was criticism in terms of the health service. We all know that as things stand, without reform, the Department of Health is going to consume more and more and more of the block grant. Already it's over 50 out of every £100 that the government has. And once this is out of the way, we are all going to have to be courageous. When Mr. Swan became the Health Minister, one of the things that I said was he should be given political cover in order to take through the Bengal recommendations, because the easiest thing for all of us to do, the easiest thing for him to do, would be to stand up and say, I need more money. And the easiest thing for the other parties to do is to say, we need health reform. So we need to be brave and not allow parochial or sectional interest in that area. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. And no other members indicating to speak. I call on Junior Minister Gordon Lance to conclude and wind the debate on all four motions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I'm grateful for members' contributions to this debate. They have certainly been comprehensive. When I saw earlier on that the Business Committee had allocated till 6:30 this evening for this debate, I thought they were being extremely generous with the time, but it does seem as if we have gone beyond that, and members have certainly made most of the time that has been available to them. I want to address the substantive points that have been raised by members in the debate here today. But perhaps first, I could address the issue that nearly all members have raised during this debate, and that is the process in which we find ourselves in here today, taking through regulations that were put in place a number of weeks ago, but we're only having the opportunity to talk and discuss them now. Members obviously, though, will be aware that this was the process that the Assembly had agreed to bring these in, that regulations would be made and they would be subject to an affirmative vote and debate in the Assembly. And it's very much right, I think, that members get the opportunity to do that as early as possible. However, under the current system, there are obviously a number of measures that have to be taken first. They have to go to the examiner of statutory rules. They need to go to the committee. They then need to go to the business committee to get time in the floor. So I understand the reason why the Health Committee have written to the First and Deputy First Ministers, asking them to look again at the process, because we are following the process and we're following the process properly, and I'm sure that members would not like it if we had taken out certain elements of the process that is currently in place. However, the First and Deputy First Minister do share members' concerns about the length of time that it is taking for regulations to come to the Assembly, and they have said that they are content to review this so that they can come to the floor of the House in a more timely manner. Though I do hope that members have recognised that the Executive Office have recognised that there was an issue with this and have made themselves available for questions whenever the ad hoc committee was available, and have obviously now been in the position where they're providing written ministerial statements and, where possible, providing a statement to the Assembly on the floor of the Assembly so that members have the opportunity at that stage to question ministers about the changes that have been made. But nevertheless, I understand that this is a less than acceptable situation that we find ourselves in, and I hope that that can be changed. I will take this opportunity just to mention comments from a number of members. Mr. McGrath is no longer in his place. He raised a number of issues around compliance, and that's very important, because if we do not have compliance with the regulations, then we're not going to get the desired outcome. So I do recognise how important that is, and I do appreciate that he recognised the work that has been done already in regards to communication, because I do think we have seen greater adherence to the regulations over the last number of weeks, and that's because of the additional communications that the Executive has put in place. And I do want to put on record, Mr. Speaker, our appreciation for all of the partners that have worked with us. Over the last number of weeks, we have had extensive engagement with local government, with retail, with hospitality, with church leaders. We're zoomed out, Mr. Speaker, because we have been wanting to engage, and I think that that has helped in particular in regards to communications. Another issue that Mr. McGrath raised, that many others raised as well, was this issue of leaks. Obviously, I believe that's something that shouldn't be happening. I very much believe that decisions should be made in the Executive. When those decisions are made, then they should then, in the first instance, where possible, come before the Assembly. I can only say that I am not responsible for these leaks, and I can provide that reassurance to the House this evening. And I hope that all members who have raised this issue might also want to raise it with their executive ministers as well, so they understand the strength of feeling in relation to this. Mr. Gildenew and Mr. Stalford, who's no longer in his place, had mentioned in particular wanting information in regards to the current estimate of R. I can inform the House that it currently sits at 0.6 to 0.9, most likely 0.7. So the current estimate of R is definitely below 1, and it is important to note that that is what we had sought to achieve, the R number at that rate, and I'm pleased that we have that now, and that hospital admissions have begun to decline slowly over the last week, but remain at a relatively high level. However, the number of COVID hospital patients should begin to decline further in the next week, but that is expected to be slow and will depend on hospital discharge. One of the good news stories in the second wave is that we do have fewer people dying as a result of this virus, but that requires them to go from ICU back into the general wards again, so that the pressure is still there because there's more people and more people who are living. So significant challenges are still there, but are heading in the right direction. Pam Cameron raised a number of issues, and in particularly the concerns were expressed by her about the distress for families who are facing a loved one who's in hospital and dying, and to reduce this distress for families and support decision making for staff with circumstances in which end-of-life care is being provided. I can confirm to the member that the Department of Health has issued updated guidance which recognises end-of-life care as being an exceptional circumstance in which restricted visitation to a patient will be permitted, regardless of the regional alert level position at that time, and this can apply to ministers of religion, as she had stated, because we know how important it is in those final moments of life to have a minister or someone from your faith community with you. So at all times, we want to balance the public health and infection control guidance with the need for compassionate care at the end of life. She did mention there is a threat to life from COVID, and she's absolutely right, but there is also a threat to life from other illnesses, and that has been very well illustrated by a number of members here today, and in particular Mr. Alistair gave us that heartbreaking account of what had happened to that young woman in his constituency, and there's no other word for that. It's just absolutely heartbreaking. That lady did not have the treatment for a time, and our hearts go out to all of the people that find themselves in that situation, because it's not an isolated incident either, and I thank the member for bringing that to the floor of the Assembly today, and for reminding us all of the many challenges that exist within healthcare and not just COVID at this time. I'm more than happy to give way to the member.
And first of all, could I take the opportunity to apologise to Lashkan Corley and to the House for my phone going off earlier in the session. But I also want to thank the Minister for the information that he has given and for undertaking that there will be a review of the processes involved. But can I also ask the Minister to raise with his executive colleagues the fact that those basic pieces of information which committees are seeking to apply their scrutiny would be available, and officials coming to committee would have, you know, basic information such as the R number at any given time or its impact on measures, not only to provide the committees with the opportunity to carry out their scrutiny role, but also to provide the public with the confidence that the measures that are being taken are necessary and are best positioned in terms of dealing with the virus.
The member has certainly put his views on the record, and I will also pass that on and get my officials to pass that on to the Department for Health. I would advise him that we only get that information once a week. It's not on a daily basis. It's not as useful as getting the bigger picture over a seven-day period. But I think it is important that not only members of the executive, but also members of the Assembly, especially those in a scrutiny role within the Department of Health, have that information, and I have no problem passing that message on to the minister. I just want to associate with myself also with the comments that Pam Cameron made in relation to the impact that this virus is having on wider society, on people, on the economy, and she'd also said on the fabric of society, and I don't think that's hyperbole. I think that this virus has the potential to change so much of how we live our lives and how we interact and relationships. It's having a big impact, and she's absolutely right. That we break that cycle of lockdown, and I'll speak more to that later on. Steve Aiken, who has also left us, had mentioned the need for a vaccine and the good news that was out today. I think that is to be welcomed. It does give us, I think, hope for the future. However, it should not make us complacent. It should not make us think that this is going to be a solution. We're still a way away from that, so we shouldn't let our guard down. And I also agree with what he said in terms of the importance, as I've already stated, of the Assembly hearing about the decisions that are made first, and that it doesn't go out via the media. Paula Bradshaw had raised the issue of whether it should be a requirement for individuals to wear a face covering in all indoor settings. That has been considered. However, I am told that evidence suggests that when there is a prolonged close contact between individuals, cloth face coverings will not offer effective protections, and therefore that extending the regulation to require blanket wearing of coverings would not be justified. There is an inconsistency, she said, in requiring junior pupils to wear face masks on public and home-to-school transport, but not in retail settings. This matter, I can inform the member, was raised at the face covering working group. It will be discussed when the face covering working group next meets. But I would note that the social distancing that has become a feature of the retail environment isn't possible on public transport, and that is something that we need to keep in mind. Jonathan Buckley raised a number of issues. He's not in the House at this moment, but I am informed that the risks of infection associated with the hospitality industry and the impact of restrictions upon the hospitality industry are well known and recognised by the executive. Finding a way through these difficult issues does not involve easy answers, and until there is a vaccine, we will continue to seek an effective way through. But I think it is right that we do thank those within the hospitality sector that have spent so much time engaging with us over the last number of weeks. We appreciate that, and we will continue to do that. We then had Pat Sheehan, who is in his place, and the more things change, the more they stay the same. No matter how often he is told to stick to the regulations at hand, he always likes to give us his current assessment of where things are at, and he was certainly comprehensive in doing that today. And that really is perhaps a matter for a further debate in the Assembly around contact tracing capacity. There has been a significant increase in the pressures faced by the service, including a threefold increase in the number of new cases notified to the CTS system on Friday, the 2nd of October. That went from 300 to 900, so that was significant. We understand the pressures that are there, and a number of mitigations have now been introduced by the Public Health Agency involving the introduction of the new texting and digital self-trace platform. I really shouldn't, but I will.
I think it's just important to point out that when the Chief Executive of the PHA attended the Health Committee a few weeks ago, she told us that the modelling that had been carried out, and she said initially it had been carried out by Ian Young and his team, the Chief Scientific Officer. She then recanted that for some reason. But what she said was that the modelling estimated that the maximum number of positive cases here would be 300. And that was the basis on which they had recruited people to do contact tracing. Now, we were getting 1,000 cases a day at that time. So, I mean, in my view, the numbers they were thinking of recruiting were a serious underestimation anyway for 300. But given that we were getting 1,000 positive cases a day, I mean, as I said earlier, the sums just don't add up. It was a woeful underestimation of what was coming at us.
It isn't really a matter for the regulations that are before us today, but I appreciate the fact that the member has raised this issue. And I can inform him that the Department of Health and PHA colleagues are currently working on a range of options for contact tracing in Northern Ireland. There's a number of options that are being considered, including a hybrid model with a focus on digital solutions to deliver early messages to contacts and cases, and includes more advanced analytics to help enable more targeted input from expert health professional staff to risk assess and deal with more complex cases and clusters or outbreaks. This work is being progressed at pace as we aim to optimise the current window afforded by the executive's interventions and the consequential short-term impact expected on virus transmission. I hope that is of some use to the member today, but no doubt he will find other avenues to raise this further as well. But I do understand the importance of that subject. Gary Middleton had rightly raised a number of issues, and I just want to answer one in particular. It's in regard to churches. And I have to say, Mr. Speaker, that I'm very proud of the fact that we have kept churches open here in Northern Ireland, and I very much hope that that will continue to be the case. I understand the importance of worship to so many people. The fact that they want to be able to come together and to worship, which is a very important part of so many people's religion, that corporate public worship. I understand how important it is for many older people in our society as well, who don't have that same interaction, perhaps, that we can have within a work environment. And we recognise the importance of that within the executive, and I think it's only right that that continues. I also believe the churches are very safe. And I can give the example of my own congregation, Mr. Speaker, and if members want to see an example of how it is done well and done safely, they're more than willing to come to my church. I extend that invitation, although there's many other reasons why members would find it beneficial as well. But I think it is important that we do allow people to meet in that way and that we recognise the right of people to express their faith and their religion. Martina Anderson had made a number of comments in relation to both of her friends, or two of her friends, sorry, who had ended up in Alton Galvin. I think it does again bring home to us the fact that this virus is among us, it is real, and it has impacts on people that we know as well. And it is important that we recognise that. To pick up on a couple of other points that she had made, first of all, in terms of financial support for businesses, that's extremely important, and the executive are continually looking at the grants and support schemes that are available. I am concerned, and a number of other colleagues have expressed concerns, and I have had many complaints from constituents about the amount of time that it's taking to get money out. That should be an absolute priority for the Department of Finance, because people do not have any other source of income. And it's really important that that gets out to them and gets out as soon as possible. And I hope that the member will also be aware that the issue of payments for those that are self-isolating is also being considered and looked at. Cara Hunter also made a number of comments in relation to mental health, and it is important that we see and recognise the impact that that is having on people here in Northern Ireland. She also made comments in relation to communication, and it is important, and I think we have ramped up communication well, and we need to continue to do that. Just then to comment, Mr. Chambers made a number of comments, and this was a theme throughout contributions from the Ulster Unionist Party about the importance of listening to the experts. We have always said that we will listen to what the experts have to say and the advice that they are given. However, I would say that Dr. McBride and Professor Young themselves have said that they are there to advise. They're not the decision makers. It's the executive, it's the ministers who make decisions, and they certainly wouldn't want it any other way. Because I think it is important that we not only look at this from a purely health point of view, and I in no way dismiss or downplay the importance of this as a health issue, but an executive, I would say we have a responsibility to look at the economy as a whole, to look at education, to look at all of these other aspects of life that are so important. And that's why we do take the recommendations and listen to the advice of the Chief Medical Officer and the Chief Scientific Advisor and others. But we also have to listen to what other ministers are saying, what other stakeholders are saying as well. That's why none of this is easy, but it does all have to be done in the round. I do want to pick up on a few comments, one in particular from Sinead McLaughlin, who I think was trying to portray the fact that we have said we need to live with the virus, that in some way we're being irresponsible. In some way, by saying we need to live with the virus, that we are saying just let it run rampant across the place and we'll just get on with things. And we also heard that from Gerry Card as well. That's not what we mean at all. And I hope that the member for Foyle recognises that as well. That's not what we want to see happen. We're not throwing caution to the wind here. What we mean when we say that we want to live with the virus is to live with it and suppress it at the same time, which I believe is possible. I believe that it is possible that we make sure that there are mitigations in place. We've done it in a number of sectors. And I have to say, some sectors have really stepped up to the mark. I've mentioned churches before already. Churches have stepped up to the mark. People are looking at how we can operate our businesses and operate gatherings and operate events that we want to see take place, while at the same time making sure we're adhering to the basic science, to social distancing where possible, and the wearing of face coverings, and the good hygiene, all of those simple messages. How can we put in those protections so that we can make sure that businesses and life can carry on as normal as possible. Because it is not sustainable, as Mrs. Cameron and others have said, to go in and out and in and out and in and out of lockdowns or interventions or whatever it may be. It's simply not sustainable. So we have to look at how we can be secure and COVID secure, and I want to thank the hospitality sector and the retail sector for the work that they have done on that so far, and how they can improve standards in the businesses in which they operate. It means we have to look at testing and tracing and contact tracing, like we've discussed with Mr. Sheehan already. We need to look at hospital capacity as well and what can be done to expand that. We need to take all of these things in the round, including testing as well. All of these things, how can we take them and build them in to make sure that we actually are living with the virus? And it is not to say that we don't think it's real or we don't need to take proper precautions. And I think that it is possible, and that's what we should want to do. And I will touch on that a little bit more later on. Mr. Butler raised a number of issues. I think I've covered what he had said about the CMO and the CSA. It's not a matter of whether we trust them or not. It's about taking their advice along with everything else and coming to a solution for the problems that we face. And I obviously have endorsed what he has said in relation to churches as well. In regards then to masks on school buses, he's saying they should be encouraged to wear a face coverings. And whilst the evidence shows that they can be important in confined settings indoors and on buses, we haven't required them to be worn outdoors. And what I would say to children waiting for the bus is that you should maintain appropriate social distancing. And I think that's the right thing to do at this moment in time. We had a few more comments from other members then. First of all, from Mr. Nesbitt. And this was a common theme again, that we shouldn't listen to anybody else other than the medical experts that are in place in the Department of Health at this moment in time. I have a lot of time and a lot of respect for our CMO and our CSA, but I think that it is wrong for us to say other medical professionals, other advisors, if you're saying anything that's contrary to what we are hearing, we don't want to hear from you. We live in a free society, and I welcome the fact that other people want to contribute to this debate. They should have the right to contribute to this debate without being shut down. If we are convinced of the evidence, of the science, and of our position, well, we should welcome interactions and interventions from other people. That's not something that we should be afraid of, and I do not want us to go down a route where people are censored because of what they have to say. I think that that would be entirely the wrong route to go down. Pat Catney made a number of comments in relation to what has been planned by the executive or what may come from the executive. I do not know what is coming, for the simple reason that I think the executive is meeting now and I'm here with you fine people instead. So I'm not able to provide him with any clarity on what is what may or may not be discussed at this time. However, I have said that it is important that whenever decisions are made, they're placed on the record in this chamber and in this place. Mr. Alistair raised a number of points in relation to the process. I've addressed those already and agree that this is not the way that we want to be doing things. And I agree with him wholeheartedly that we shouldn't be afraid to hear other points of view either. And just to move on then to Mr. Carroll's statement. He obviously raised concerns in relation to the process that we have here for regulations that are coming in. He loves to have a go at Stormont and the power and the control and the supposed secrecy that there is here. Of course, it's Mr. Carroll who wants an ever more powerful state that goes into every aspect of our lives, and that was evidenced by what he has said today. I cannot understand the aversion that he has to economic freedom And to people that are wanting to do things for themselves, and for his continual rants about capitalism. There's not much more that can be said to that. Some people have said that others have tried to sectarianise COVID. For Mr. Carr, it seems that he wants to bring in socialism at every opportunity as the solution to all of... we're probably going to hear the same old nonsense, but yes, I'll give way to him.
Just to say to the Minister, I think there's nothing wrong with wanting to expand the state, especially the NHS, as many people, I'm sure himself, clap for it during this pandemic, but that's certainly not my definition of socialism, and I'm happy to give you a full definition of that sometime in this chamber, if the Speaker allows.
Of course, the Member doesn't just want to expand the NHS, does he? He wants more government control in every aspect of our lives here. And we have seen what socialism does, and I am quite happy to stand here and be a supporter of economic freedom, because it's the economic freedom that brings prosperity to people. And we only have to look at some of the regimes that he would support to see what socialism does. The Member has nothing to say that I think is of any value or would add anything to this conversation. Yes, I will give way.
The Minister giving way, just as he's addressing Mr. Carroll, could he advise him, you're not meant to put your mask under your chin, you're not meant to touch it, you're meant to take it off appropriately, and he sends out a very dangerous message to the wider public by the way in which he's actually not wearing the mask appropriately.
I think we're getting to a point there where we're starting to bring this into a bit of a farce, so can we get to the business and invite the Minister back on his feet again to conclude the debate? Thank you.
I thank the Member for his intervention, and I think it is important that we lead by example in this place. He also mentions Mr. Wilson. Mr. Wilson is, of course, as the Member of Parliament for East Antrim, he is free to express his views. It seems, however, that Mr. Wilson seems to be living rent-free in his head, and I would just advise him not to get caught up in what others say or do. It's not always good for us to be obsessed in that way. Of course, I've missed Mr. Stalford, and I agree with the points that he has made, and I hope that I've answered his question as well in relation to the R number. So, Mr. Speaker, I do want to acknowledge how difficult these regulations have been for so many people. Yes, for some, they are a minor nuisance or inconvenience, but I recognise that for so many more, they are having a major impact on their lives. I understand that they are keeping people away from their families. They are having a yet unquantified impact on people's well-being, and they are causing huge uncertainty and worry for many people about their jobs and businesses. Like many other members, I too have heard from those who have built up their businesses over many years, who have spent energy and effort and thousands of hours trying to build them up, and for some now, they have depleted their savings and they're worried about their survival. And that's why it's so important that we do everything in our power to make sure that we get out of this cycle of lockdowns. And I am pleased to report that good progress has been made through our interaction with retail, hospitality, faith leaders, local government and key players, to ensure that we can get to a place where we live with COVID in a way that does not require the type of intervention that the Assembly is discussing today. And the interventions, whilst effective, are far too blunt a tool for the problem that we are facing. It is simple and straightforward to tell people to stay away from work, to stay at home, and not do the things that we're so used to doing. It's very straightforward. But it's not realistic for us to do it any longer. We can and we must do better because there is so much at stake. However, it is only right that we acknowledge the sacrifice of so many, and that sacrifice has paid off. So I do want to say today, thank you. Thank you to the majority of those who are abiding by the rules. You have caused the R rate to fall, and transmission is falling, hospitals' admissions are falling, and it is therefore inevitable that ICU admissions will fall and deaths will fall too. Mr. Speaker, it's certainly the case that all too often politicians and experts seem to be bringing a message of doom. And it's certainly true that we find ourselves in a difficult time, and this is no time for complacency. However, I have no doubt that we will get beyond this difficult winter, and 2021 will be much better than 2020. We will get better at living with this, we will find a vaccine, and life will get back to normal again. However, in the meantime, we need to adapt, get smarter, and get better so we can live through COVID. It is important that we recognise our healthcare professionals at this time. They are deserving of so much praise. I spoke over the weekend to a nurse who is working in an ICU ward, and it is really difficult for them. They are finding it tough. They are under strain. Having already done their jobs so valiantly through the first wave, they're now under pressure once more. And I am incredibly grateful for all that they have done. And I know that it might sound trite and cliched to say so, but I highlight this so the public might be aware, and those who are not taking it seriously might think twice. I say to them that your actions have an impact and could lead to increasing pressure on our doctors and our nurses who are already getting it tight. So, Mr. Speaker, I am grateful for the contributions that members have made today. There is much for us to take away on this, not least the process by which we find ourselves, the process that we find ourselves going through today. And if there are any issues that I have missed in the debate, I will, of course, write to members. But we all have a responsibility to help curb the spread of this virus. And I think the most important thing that we can say, and this is the advice that we're getting from our medical experts, is do the simple things. It's about maintaining social distancing, maintaining good hand hygiene, wearing face coverings, self-isolating if we experience symptoms, downloading the app, and complying with all the restrictions in place. Mr. Speaker, it's certainly the case that none of us like these restrictions. None of us want these restrictions to be in place for any longer than they have to be. But we are informed that this is what we need to see happen at this moment in time. So I reluctantly commend these regulations to the House.
Thank you. And the question is that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Number 2, Amendment Number 8, Regulations NI 2020 be approved. All those in favour say aye. The contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. We will now move on to the second motion on the health protection regulations, which have already been debated. And I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Number 2, Amendment Number 9, Regulations Northern Ireland 2020 be approved.
Thank you. And I call the junior minister to move a motion.
Beg to move.
Thank you. The question is that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Number 2, Amendment Number 9, Regulations NI 2020 be approved. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. We will now move on to the third motion on the Health Protection Regulations, which has already been debated. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Number 2, Amendment Number 9, Regulations Northern Ireland 2020 be approved.
Thank you. And I call the junior minister to move the motion.
I'd like to move.
Thank you. And the question is that the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Number 2, Amendment Number 10, Regulations NI 2020 be approved. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. We will now move on to the fourth motion on the health protection regulations, which has already been debated, and I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That the Health Protection Coronavirus Wearing of Face Coverings Amendment Number 2, Regulations Northern Ireland 2020 be approved.
Thank you. I call the junior minister to move the motion.
I beg to move.
Thank you. The question is that the Health Protection Coronavirus Wearing of Face Coverings Amendment Number 2, Regulations NI 2020 be approved. All those in favour say aye. The contrary, no. The ayes again have it. Thank you, members. Will members please take your ease for a moment or two?